So when I was a sophomore in high school, we were all turning 16 and everybody in my school was getting cars. I had to buy my own car, but I went to a school with a lot of really spoiled kids, so it wasn't unusual for kids to get cars for their 16th birthday. And I guess a few girls, you know, really liked attention, they were pretty popular, and therefore they wanted to get their car in front of the entire school, you know, really make a spectacle out of it. So one day there's a pep rally, we're all chilling, hanging out, getting hyped for, I don't even know, I never liked college, like high school football, not college football. But I guess it was really important for my friends that I went, so I ended up going to this pep rally. And there was this cheerleader at the time. For this story, I'm going to call her Megan. Her name was Megan. And Megan was one of the most spoiled people I'd ever met in her my entire life. She was super entitled. She always acted like she was better than everybody because her dad was rich. And she was just not a very pleasant person. But whatever, we go through the pep rally. They're doing their cheerleading thing. And after the pep rally, there's an announcement. It's like, everybody go outside to the blah, 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 like this little area next to our parking lot, right? So we all go out there, and this Megan girl's dad pulls up in a brand new white BMW, right? Beautiful car, brand new, like I said, just off the lot. And he gets out of the car and says, happy birthday, Megan. And you would think Megan goes, holy cow, man, that's like a $50,000, $60,000 sedan. It's a brand new BMW. That's incredible. Wow, ah, wow, thank you, Dad. This really means a lot to me. But no, 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 no. It can't be that simple, can it, people? Can't be grateful for things that your parents give you in life. Come on, that's too easy. So spoiled Sally over here, instead of being like, ah, thanks for the brand new BMW, Dad, walks up to the car and starts crying, like sobbing tears. And we're all like, ah, so grateful. She's crying tears of, you know, gratitude. Oh, thanks, Dad. This car's so sick. I'm gonna cry. I guess people do that sometimes. I've never personally cried out of thankfulness. But, you know, maybe Megan's a little weird. And then we hear it, a shriek, a cry, almost as if she found her own child eating Legos and glue at the same time and realized he was going to grow up to become named Melvin. A cry that will forever be emblazoned in my head like a brand on a cow. I don't know, something that's permanent, okay? It's the wrong car! And everybody just kind of goes slack-jawed like, what did she just say? Did she actually just say this? Did this homegirl actually just say the words, it's the wrong car to a brand new BMW? I cannot believe what I'm hearing. I don't want to hear what I'm hearing. This is ridiculous, it's insane, but it's a good meme. Like, for the rest of high school, we all used to go, it's the wrong car, whatever a minor inconvenience would happen, you know? Like, whenever somebody's flash drive wouldn't work, it's the wrong car. Like, it was just a good meme, you know? Make fun of the girl that's super spoiled. But whatever, here she is sobbing, screaming that it's the wrong car, in front of the entire school, by the way. It's not like she's having a temper tantrum by herself. Literally, everyone at the pep rally is sitting here, watching the spoiled brat cry about it being the wrong car. And the dad doesn't get mad. He doesn't say, well, I just bought you a car, so like you're gonna like it. No. He goes, oh, sweetie, it's okay. Here, just get in it and drive it home. And she's like, okay, and gets in the car and drives home. But before she drives away, she says the most powerful last words of all time. I want a white Camaro. It's not a white Camaro. You ruined my birthday. If my parents ever gave me a car, it could be like a 1999 Toyota Corolla with three wheels. I'd still be hype. I don't even care. But whatever, apparently it wasn't a brand new white Camaro, so it just doesn't count. Your parents don't love you unless they spend an extra, you know, $50,000 on you. That's just the truth, okay, guys? Come on. If your parents haven't bought you at least four cars, they hate you. That's what I'm learning. So here I am thinking, oh, that's the end of the story. She's gonna keep the BMW, they're gonna talk about it, she's gonna think it over and be like, wow, that was a really generous gift. Most people don't get a nice car like this. No, 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 no. The next day, we're walking through the parking lot, and what do we see but a brand new white Camaro that's just being driven into the parking lot by no one else other than Megan. I guess her dad had taken back the BMW to the dealership and bought her the brand new white Camaro she wanted. And I think if you actually do that, your kid is basically guaranteed to become Hitler. Like, think about it this way. You let your daughter cry in front of the entire school and make you look like an idiot over the brand new car that you bought her, the luxury sedan, and then when she cries and claims she wants a different car, instead of being like, yeah, no, you're a spoiled, entitled brat, eat shit, you go out and buy her the car she wants! I don't understand what's wrong with people these days. I don't understand if they just never read a parenting book or whatever. Like, I've never read a parenting book, but I'm pretty sure there's a big sign on, like, every page of a parenting book saying, don't do exactly what you just did. So yeah, Megan proceeded to be the worst human being for the next, last 2 years of high school. Definitely not too pleasant, but she did have a white Camaro, so I mean, she was the real winner here, okay? I'm too poor to understand her struggles. The worst part is, it was a beautiful car, but like, by the time that we were graduating, she never knew how to drive a car like that. So, of course, it would rattle when it started. It was never taken care of very well because something tells me that a 16-year-old girl does not exactly understand how to take care of a muscle car, especially one that cried over getting a BMW. Probably not the best, you know, car owner that we've ever seen.
Anyways, what's going on, guys? You guys really like whenever I talk about spoiled kids, so this incident happened when I was about 16 years old, right about the time where people are, like, getting the confidence to try adult things, you know, like becoming a musician or having a career, but they're still 16, so they're not very good at it yet, and there was this one kid in our school who I'm gonna name, I don't know, let me think of a good spoiled kid named Brandon. Brandon is a good name for a spoiled kid. I feel like Brandons tend to be a little bit douchey. And Brandon really, really wanted to be a musician, you know, and I got nothing against that. Doing music, do whatever you gotta do. Like, really, really no big deal whatsoever. I really have nothing against it, but he was like one of those kids who wanted to be a musician, but thought it was cool to like constantly talk trash to everybody else about how much better he was than them at music. Even if you weren't even talking trash about music, like legitimately, you could just be chilling in the lunchroom, you know, eating a nice cheese stick, some nice mozzarella melting in your mouth. You're feeling everything right. And out of nowhere, Brandon's head come like shooting out from under the lunch table. Hey guys, I'm a better singer than you. And you like, dude, I'm trying to eat a cheese stick. Nobody cares. He was just one of those kids that never knew when to stop bragging, and it was always really annoying. And anyways, he really wanted to be a musician, and more power to you. Like I said, if you want to make music, go for it. And his parents kind of had money, and he went around one day basically telling everybody that he was going to go to California and make a song with, like, some guy who produces music for Justin Bieber, and how he was going to get signed to a record label and film a music video. And by the time he came back to school, if he came back to school and wasn't signed and famous, then, like, I guess we could all see it, and he might throw a premiere party for his music video. And he had made it sound like, you know, that the record label had come out and paid for all of this, like they desperately wanted him to come out. And I was kind of suspicious of the fact that his mom and dad had just paid for it all, because he wasn't that good at singing. Like, I'm not gonna say he was bad, he was probably slightly above average in terms of talent when it comes to singing, but he was definitely not good enough for Justin Bieber's producer to hit him up and be like, yo, you've never made a song before, but you got the pipes, let me fly you and your family out to California. He was not that good. So whatever, Brandon goes to LA for the week, and the entire time he's sending everybody Snapchats and like Instagram posts of him like living it up, you know, and he's posting like, while you guys are stuck in school, I'm at lunch with music producers. We're not the same. Like, just being as obnoxious as humanly possible. And for some reason, like, only the guys were bothered by this. All the girls are like, no, come on, guys. He's just enjoying his success. But enjoying your success doesn't mean that you have to, like, make fun of everybody else for sucking and having to be at school. Sorry that I'm a kid who has to go to school and I'm not getting flown out to LA to produce music. My bad, dude. You know, like, it's just not a good look. Like, I'm a YouTuber, right? Imagine if I open every video with, like, what's up, losers who don't have a cool job? You guys suck balls and I don't. Like, it's just not a good look, you know? So anyways, he's gone for the week, and like the entire time he's hyping everybody up about how cool his music video is gonna be. And this is like not around the time of Friday, it was after it a little bit, probably 2 or 3 years after, but like around the time when there was that string of parents just paying producers to make their kid famous, and they would make him a crappy music video, and then like it would get millions of views on YouTube, but not in a good way. This guy's didn't end up getting millions of views. I actually went and found it. It has like 26,000 views. It only really got famous at our school. But he comes back, and like the first little bit he's back, he's talking about how there's a team of editors working on his music video, and how he has video effects specialists making his music video, and like we probably wouldn't understand it because we're too dumb to understand the computers that they're using to make his video. But like obviously it's going to be fantastic. Once again, just trying to make sure that we know that we suck and he is in fact better than us because his mom and dad paid a bunch of money to get a music video made for him. Typical shenanigans. So whatever, he convinces somehow the principal to premiere this music video. And like, this isn't elementary school, by the way. This is high school. We're like 16. So it is weird to get gathered in the auditorium. Usually the only time that ever happened was on like assembly days, and I never went to the assemblies because I don't really care if our football team wins or loses, you know, I'm just trying to go home. But we get drawn down there in the middle of the day to like support one of our students' success and push them forward and like hopefully their future career. You know how the principal is. She heard that he made a song with someone who's worked with Justin Bieber and thought this was her chance to, like, get a news story about how one of her students was all successful. So she's taking full advantage. You know, everybody has to be supportive and happy. So we all get rounded into this auditorium like cattle, like into this gym. And they have two projectors on either side ready to play this video on the projectors, right? And I'm just letting you guys know now. The video is, it's not good. Like, it's so not good that the other half of the video is me basically telling you how bad it is. So it opens up on, like, this sunset, right? And he's, like, driving this car, which, I mean, he just turned 16, fair enough. It's not like it's a 14-year-old driving. And he's driving down the street, and then out of nowhere, this, like, horribly CGI'd pterodactyl comes out of nowhere, straight out of the left side of the screen. And you know how he told us that he had, like, a team of VFX people working on it, and how, you know, there was a team of the best editors making sure that the CGI was great, dude. These pterodactyls look like a turd with wings just flying through the sky towards this car. And the best part is, like, they when the pterodactyls start to attack the car, because that's what they go to do, they had obviously just, like, put the car in front of the green screen, because they didn't even use, like, the same color blue in the sky when he was actually driving to when he's, like, fighting the pterodactyls. So he's fighting the pterodactyls in this terrible green screen, and then one of them, like, picks him up and takes him off. And the entire time that this is happening, there's a song playing. And the song, like I said, the guy wasn't a bad singer. Like, he was good. I mean, he wasn't fantastic. Like, I would never pay to hear him sing, but, like, you know, better than average. And I don't know why whoever did this to him used as much auto-tune as they did, but it really, really sounded like Mr. Robot just moaning into the microphone. Like, it was like, I'm on my way. Oh, yeah. Like, it sounded like C-3PO and R2-D2 talking crap in their native tongue. And at this point, nobody is doing anything, right? Because we're all speechless. Keep in mind, he told us that he's working with somebody that's working with Justin Bieber. And here we are listening to, like, you know, C-3PO on the microphone. Oh yeah, I love it when you call me baby. Like, it was bad, guys, trust me. Like, as somebody who's listened to a lot of horrible music, I've made some horrible music, I can tell you when it's bad. It was bad, right? And if it's bad, that's okay. But when you have the confidence to get in front of the entire school and premiere it and, like, show everybody and it's this bad, it's not good. So the poopy pterodactyls, the bad singing, everybody is just kind of in shock. And he has this smug look on his face. And I realize, looking at him, he thinks that everybody is in shock because of how good this is. Like, he honestly thinks that everybody is just like, oh my God, this is so amazing, I can't speak. I've never seen anything this beautiful. He thinks we're out here watching the solar eclipse, and in the reality, we're just watching some guy absolutely murder his social life with a horrible music video. Anyways, then something happens that makes everybody kind of react. Like, up to that point, everybody's just kind of in awe of what's happening. So he gets taken by the pterodactyls, and he gets taken back to their nest, and he gets put down, and there's, like, this big egg. And the egg is a little too big to be a baby pterodactyl, and it starts to shake. And he's, like, all scared, and the song is still playing in the background, and he's looking at the egg like a shocked child in a National Geographic magazine, just like, oh my God, look at the wonder of the earth. He's from America. He didn't have an accent, but, like, that fit the moment, okay? All right? Just stop complaining. So, regardless, he's looking at this egg, and it's, like, shaking, and it cracks open, and two human hands come out, and you're like, wait, how did a human get in this egg? Like, I have so many questions. And sure enough, a CGI Justin Bieber pops out. And when I say CGI Justin Bieber, that's me being polite. I knew what it was supposed to be, but, like, if Justin Bieber saw what they made him look like in CGI form, he might sue from defamation, because it honestly looked like Justin Bieber after he had just gotten in a fight with, like, a skillet in his face. So, obviously, everybody starts laughing as soon as CGI Justin Bieber is on, dude. Like, I'm sorry. You can't be making a music video and telling us that you have a team of CGI artists on it and, like, come out with Justin Bieber looking out of a Nintendo 64 video game onto the screen. It just does not look good. The graphics were horrible. You know, IGN wouldn't even give it a 10 out of 10, and they will give literally anyone willing to pay them 10 out of 10. So, like, obviously everybody's laughing, and that's when he realizes that this is not going as well as he thought. So he starts looking around, and he's mortifyingly embarrassed. And I know a lot of you guys are probably like, oh my gosh, that poor kid. But keep in mind, he chose to have it premiered in front of the entire school. He had already seen it. Like, what do you expect to happen, dude? You've been hyping it up. You're the reason we're all watching it. Nobody really wants to be watching it. But he gets mortifyingly embarrassed and, like, runs out of the gymnasium. And the principal, like, stops the music video and gets on the microphone. Guys, stop laughing, guys. Come on. Is that the spirit that we have at this school? Guys, we are supposed to be... Guys, this is not funny. Stop. It's not funny, guys. You know how principals are, where they're, like, trying to get everybody to stop laughing, but they just sound like an angry mom, like, complaining, so nobody stops laughing. You know how it is. So, she's trying to calm everybody down and not make fun of him, and I guess, like, his close friends are all out there huddled around him, and he's, like, crying, you know, like, I'm so embarrassed. Yeah, you should be, dude. Your music video sucked, and you premiered it in front of everybody. And so, like... Obviously, after all this time of telling everybody how much they suck compared to him for not having a crazy music video made and, like, how great it was gonna be. And as everybody's leaving to go to lunch or, like, their other classes after this assembly, people are kind of yelling things at him, you know, like, oh, nice video, nice singing, like, just messing with them. And finally, he stands up and, like, snaps and is screaming and is like, it was good, you guys just don't understand art. Yeah, that's right. Everybody who thinks it sucked. Like, 90% of people thinks it sucked. But that's because 90% of people are really stupid, and you're the only smart one that can understand it. Yeah, definitely. So he's freaking out fighting with people, which doesn't help. Like, up to this point, all week, he's been a giant spoiled brat telling us how much better he is than us. Like, in LA, he was saying how dumb everybody at school is. Like, he was just not being a nice person, and he expected everybody to be nice to him when he's failed, which is not how it works. Karma has different plans. You know how karma works. The vibes were just straight up not vibing. So the vibes were just straight up not vibing. That doesn't even make sense. But he's freaking out because people are insulting him, but he's been a spoiled brat all along, so I don't really know what he expected. So the principal comes out and is like, guys, no making fun of him. We're supposed to be a unified school over the intercom, and anybody who's found to be bullying will immediately be punished to the fullest extent of the rules, which includes suspension, which doesn't make things better once again. When you're being made fun of and you deserve it, like, if you do a music video and it sucks and you force me to watch it, and then everybody's making fun of you because you hyped it up, that's the worst idea, is to get the principal to come on and, like, beg people to stop. Because if anything, that just eggs people on even more. If you do something and you deserve to get made fun of, trying to shut it down just eggs everybody on. So, obviously, the joke for the rest of the year from then on is being able to make fun of his music video without directly making fun of his music video and being able to get in trouble. Like, people would, you know, ask him to sing songs like, yo, can you sing this verse from that song? And he would know you were making fun of him and hated it. But whenever you would complain about it, you could just be like, no, we were just asking him to sing the song. But yeah, moral of the story is, if you want people to support your music video, maybe don't go around calling them, like, poor, stupid idiots who, you know, have no idea how to make music, and then make a terrible music video with CGI pterodactyls and a fake Justin Bieber. But, you know, what do I know about being popular, right? I only have 2 channels with 1 million subs.
So this story takes place when I was working at the movie theater. You know, I've only had a couple real jobs in my life, but you guys know that. And something about movie theaters actually bring out the worst in people, okay? Whether it's Karens constantly complaining about something, people trying to, like, record movies, people yelling at me for things I can't control, you know? I once had an old lady get in my face and yell at me for 20 minutes because her movie was too long. Like, sorry, you dumb hoe, did you not look up the runtime before you bought the tickets? Yes, me, the lowly concession worker. Clearly, I have an impact on the runtime of movies. Let me call up Disney real quick and let them know that the movies are going a little bit too long for your gray hairs. That's the type of people I dealt with on a daily basis in this movie theater. So I was dealing with the worst of the worst. And for some reason, kids are just the worst in movie theaters too. Like, I hope if I was ever this bad as a kid in movie theater, someone would slap me, because they definitely deserved it 9 times out of 10. And this is definitely no exception to the rule. So it was a big opening weekend. I don't remember what it was, but it was some little kid movie that basically every little kid and their mom was coming to see. It might have been Toy Story 3. I don't remember what movie it was. It was a big kid movie, okay? It was one of those kids movies that basically every little kid and their mom is cropping across the country in their minivans to come watch. So all weekend, I am dealing with screaming children, complaining parents, moms that look like they just want to drink a whole bottle of wine and forget that they ever had a child. And, you know, I'm pretty much at my wit's end. I can only deal with, like, stupid people for so long, and, you know, Like screaming toddlers and moms yelling at the toddlers are not the most fun people to deal with all day. But whatever, it's getting near the end of my shift on Sunday and I don't have to work the next week. So I'm hyped to get out of here so that way I never have to hear Buzz or Woody say anything again. I think it was Toy Story 3. Because trust me, I am way over it at this point. This weekend has not been fun. This weekend has not been great. I'm not having a good time. Not to mention, I was usually cleaning theaters after movies, but for some reason this weekend I was in concessions, which is the worst because you have to deal with people all the time. And dealing with people is just so annoying. Like, look, I work here, okay? But the amount of people that would complain to me about popcorn prices like I somehow am the CEO of this movie theater is beyond me. So I'm getting to the end of my time. I'm really running out, and there's one more showing of this movie. One more. I just have to make it one more giant rush, and then I'm off for the week, and I don't have to sweat about it anymore. And I'm, like, counting down the hours until this rush comes in so I can just get it over with, okay? I've got my battle helmet. I've got my sword ready. Charge at me if you dare, you foul beasts and mothers. I will take you on one at a time. No scopes only all along the way. So this giant rush comes in, and there's one kid in the back who is already throwing a temper tantrum. And I don't know if your kid is throwing a temper tantrum while you think trying to lock him in a dark movie theater is a good idea. But whatever, we get to the front, and both of his parents are here, and you can tell right away that Timmy is an only child in a really rich family, because he starts barking orders. His parents are standing here, and little Timmy is ordering. And he orders 3 large popcorns, 4 large drinks, just starts going off. And I'm kind of waiting and looking at the mom like, is this correct? And she's like, well, he did order, didn't he? So I'm like, oh, okay, it's gonna be one of those, where I have to take orders from a toddler, because you're a bad parent. Whatever, fine. So I go get them all their stuff, and I'm coming back, and little Tommy goes, I want the souvenir cup. And his mom says, no, the souvenir cup is $15. You're not gonna get it. And you know, finally the mom's showing some backbone. I'm like, yeah, that's right, little Tommy, you're not getting the souvenir cup now, you little hoe. You're not getting any of this, you little stink bug. But whatever. So I give her the total, and she's like, there's no way it's that much. And I'm like, okay, it's that much. You ordered 3 large popcorns, all these candy, all these drinks. It's that much money. Everyone knows that stuff at a movie theater is expensive. That's why I looked at you and was like, is this okay? Because it's not cheap to eat at the movie theaters, you giant dingleberry. So she starts arguing with me about how there's no way the price is correct, and I'm trying to gouge her so I can take home money for myself. And I'm like, look, lady, if you want to talk to my manager, you're more than welcome to. I'm almost off. I don't have time or energy to fight with you right now, especially when you're taking orders from a 5-year-old. You're really intimidating. Oh, let me talk to your manager like I didn't just watch you get bossed around by a 6-year-old who can barely read Clifford the Big Red Dog. Sure, let me go get my manager because I'm definitely trying to steal your $47. That's really going to make a big difference to me. Whatever. So I go and get my manager. My manager comes back out, and her and him are talking about it. And I guess the kid had had enough of this, okay? Because I'm sitting here with my manager because whatever, I don't know why. She's talking to my manager, I'm talking to my manager, we're all having this conversation, but little Toby, little spoiled brat over here, had, I guess, finally had enough of his mother not letting him go sit in his movie theater and drink his icy. Because what comes out of his mouth next might have actually been one of the funniest things I've ever heard, alright? So while this lady is yelling at me and my manager about how stupid we are, little Tommy pipes up and says, Mom, are you poor or something? Just pay him, you got the stuff. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is out of control. So she turns around and tells little Tommy, excuse me? And he says, what? You're acting like you're broke. Like, come on, just pay for it, you stupid idiot. I want to watch my movie. And, you know, at this point, I'm really torn because on one hand, how do you talk to your mom like that? But on your other hand, please keep talking to your mom like that because this is hilarious. Like, I'm sorry, if little Tommy's calling you out, you know you're being ridiculous. Here's this spoiled little kid who just ordered half the entire department just being like, yo, Mom, you stupid idiot, pay for it, I want to go watch my movie. And the mom is obviously embarrassed, she turns beet red, and she turns over and starts yelling at us more intensely, almost to, like, prove to her kid that she's doing the right thing. And the kid pipes up and he goes, Mom, if you don't pay for it, you're making me and Dad look like a bunch of broke boys, and I can't have this. And this kid couldn't have been older than, like, 6. Like, he's ordering, he's very eloquent, I can't lie. Obviously, they've been educating him well, because he knows quite a few words. But whatever, he's calling his mom a broke hoe. He's saying that him and his dad don't want to look like broke boys. And the dad, like, nodded his head in agreement when the kid said it, too. It wasn't like the kid said it and the dad went, whoa, 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 hold on, buddy. The dad, like, nodded his head, like, yeah, you know, you are making us look like broke boys. Like, come on, you stupid hoe. Like, let's get it together. So the mom embarrassingly just goes like, fine, whatever. Put it on my card. And the kid pipes up one last time and goes, I want my souvenir cup. Otherwise, you know, you're going to pay for our embarrassment when I get home. Like, excuse me, buddy. You're 6 years old and you're telling your mom that she's going to pay for embarrassing you when you get home? You are a brave soul. I would not be surprised if you didn't make it halfway through this movie without a chonkla being entering the back of your head. But whatever, man. I rung up that survivor cup, the souvenir souvenir cup, and I said, have a great day, because you just paid $15 extra, made yourself look like an idiot, and got punked by a 6-year-old. Like, I'm sorry, how are you 35 years old and a mother, and getting punked by your 6-year-old child and your husband while you're waiting to get into a movie, you know? Like, that's just too good. So whatever, a couple hours go by, and on the way out, the kid walks up to the thing again with his mom and says, we want 2 more souvenir cups because my mom and dad need one. And I look at the mom and she goes, what he said. So I ring up the souvenir cups and she pays for them, and the kid looks at me and goes, I'm super sorry for my mom's embarrassing behavior earlier. I promise you it won't happen again. And I'm like, okay, dude, all right. Like, dang, this kid really just bullied his parents. No joke, just embarrassed his mother on a whole new level. Schooled his mom. 6-year-old came out the cut with some, I'm gonna make my mom spend more money because you made me look like a dummy. And you know what, kid, if you're out there listening to this, I hope you still have your souvenir cups, because it was far and away the most magical experience I've ever had. Like, it was like Disneyland. You ever seen a Karen get that smug look wiped off her face, you know? Here she was talking to me and my manager, acting all smug, like I somehow was robbing her of her time and joy. And then her son slapped her in the face with a burst of reality, which was, you have no control here, woman. I do. And if your house is being run by a 6-year-old, hey, that's your problem, man. You need to work on your parenting skills. Regardless, kid, if you're out there, you're a national hero. I have a statue dedicated to you in my bedroom that I pray to every night, that you will watch over me and give me the courage to do what's correct, because you were great. And yeah, I'm sure the kid's an absolute spoiled brat, don't get me wrong. Like, I'm not saying he's a good person. You shouldn't yell at your mom and make her look like a poor person. But as far as hilarity goes, it was really funny. And I'm going to prioritize being funny over being a good person any day of the week. Now, I went to a pretty bougie high school, all right? I went to the type of high school where some kids could probably buy the teacher, you know? Like, that's the type of high school I was really interactive with. And a lot of the kids that I went to high school with kind of reminded me of, you know the mean kids in all the movies where they're like, my dad runs an oil rig, and then they proceed to laugh while burning $100 bills and singing reggae? Yeah. That was a lot of the kids that went to my school. And for some reason, there was this one group of girls that everybody kind of knew was just the most spoiled brats in town. Like, by far and away, these were the type of girls that parents were loaded and would get them anything they wanted, and they were super unbearable. Like, nobody liked being around them because all they cared about was how many Instagram followers you had and how much money your parents made, which is just kind of a weird flex. Like, listen, okay, flexing about how rich your parents are makes no sense. Let me get this straight. Aha, that's right. When I was born, my dad was rich. I haven't done anything, but my dad is rich. Like, that's not really a flex. Good for you, your dad's rich. I'm sure your life is pretty lit, but it's not really a thing you want to go around high school telling everyone, like, I'm better than you because my dad makes more money than your dad. It makes you look like a grade A female dog if you're picking up what I'm putting down. If Susan could not demonetize me, that would be great. Anyways, there was this group of girls that everybody knew was just like these spoiled girls, and this takes place when I was like 15, almost 16, so basically everybody in my grade is having their 16th birthdays, you know? And it's kind of a cool thing in America when you turn 16 to get a car, and most people aren't lucky enough to have their parents buy them a car, you know? Like, I had to work 2 summer jobs and work at it for 2 years to get my first car, you know? I definitely was not balling out, rimming out. My mom wasn't buying me a brand new Mustang just because I turned 16. And most kids in my school definitely were getting cars from their parents, but it wasn't, you know, the pick of the mill, you get whatever you want. It was like, you know, your mom drives an old Toyota Camry, we're gonna give that to you and you can drive it type of thing. So most kids were pretty grounded. They turned 16, they'd get, they either buy their car, get a job for their car, their parents would give them an old car, and that's just kind of how it went. And most people were really grateful. I mean, if your parents are gonna give you a car, clearly they love you at least a little bit, you know? Like, nowhere along the line, if your parents are giving you a car, you're gonna be in a Dr. Phil episode because your mom locked you in the basement and made you play Fortnite for 15 hours a day like my mom does, you know? For the most part, most people were pretty grateful. Most people at my school were pretty chill about the fact that their parents would give them a car. I'm like, wow, it's so cool, yeah, I have a car. I'm 16 years old, and my mom and dad gave me a car. That's crazy. Like, most people should be happy to get a car. But of course, the spoiled girls' birthdays start coming up, and they go out, and they just get, like, the prettiest cars ever, you know? There were 3 of them, and the first one, who I'll just call Megan, got a brand new Mercedes, you know? Because nothing says smart decision like giving a 16-year-old who can barely drive, let alone barely have brain cells. Like, it's not like these girls were super intelligent people that, you know, worked hard and were gonna go to Harvard. No, these girls were all kind of stupid, too. So let's give a stupid girl a brand new Mercedes just because she turned 16. That was the theology her parents had, all right? So Megan gets out, gets a brand new Mercedes, and is flexing on it constantly, which just annoyed a lot of people, because once again, you didn't buy it, Megan. It's not like you worked back-to-back shifts at Dairy Queen to save up enough for your brand new Mercedes. Your dad bought it for you. And then the next one, who I'm going to call Ashley, got a brand new BMW. You know, they were the luxury car squad, really just whipping out, and it was a white BMW, and it was a really pretty car. But whatever, as you guys know, you know, so now we have a Mercedes and a BMW, and there's a third one that everybody knew was just the most spoiled girl in the world. And all these girls, when they get their fancy cars, are like, honestly, like, my dad is just, like, so sweet. Like, he bought me, like, a BMW and a Mercedes. So, you know what? Sure, it's annoying that they're flexing it constantly and always working it in a conversation, but at least they're thankful to their parents. But there was one girl who I'm gonna call Marissa. And Marissa was a grade A, well, Marissa was a bitch, okay? There's really no other way to say it. No one had ever had a pleasant interaction with her. Nowhere in the history of the world has anyone ever been sitting there going, ah, I sure hope Marissa comes into class and talks to me. Because honestly, talking to Marissa was a lot like talking to an Asian carp. You know, sure, they have a brain. Yeah, they can swim. Sure, they can eat. But outside of that, there's not much going on up there, okay? Marissa was basically a fish. She had the attention span of a goldfish and the intelligence of a stupid fish. Like, not even a smart fish, all right? Not the guy on the can of salmon or tuna who has the little smile. No. Marissa was basically a stupid fish. And anyways, Marissa was not only a spoiled girl, but she loved attention. Like, basically, this girl fed off of attention. If no one was paying attention to her, you could best assume that she was going to have a panic attack and 100% going to freak out, get everybody to pay attention for her, just be the absolute worst type of person, all right? Like, if we're listening in class, listening to George Washington crossing the Delaware, she would bring up that one time she was on a river. Like, that's just the type of girl that she was, and I hated her the most. The other spoiled girls, yeah, they were annoying sometimes, but like, hey, the ball bounces, you got lucky with the dad. Marissa, I actually strongly disliked because she was just... I just wanted to punch her in the face sometimes, okay? There's no other way to say it. There's no nice way to say it. Everybody has somebody that they just want to punch in the face, and that's how it is sometimes. And Marissa was just that person for me, you know? Just an absolute annoying bimbo that I wanted to see fight Donkey Kong and Super Smash Bros. That's all I ever wanted in life. That's all I ever need. Nintendo, if you're listening, please make it happen. But yeah, it's coming up on Marissa's 16th birthday, and she, of course, loves attention. And there's a gathering of students, also known as an assembly, coming up, you know? Basically, once a month, I would be forced to sit down with all the people I went to high school with and cheer about shit I don't care about, like our football team. Like, yeah, go football team. That always loses every game, even when we're cheering them on. But basically, we'd all get gathered into the auditorium and just be forced to sit there and hear about how great our school is, even though we're all sitting there wishing that we could just go home. It's a Friday. I got out of class an hour early. I don't want to go to an assembly. I want to shut up, go home, play some Fortnite, and double dab on all the haters, you know? But whatever. It's her 16th birthday, I think, the next day. It was like, her birthday was Saturday, and Friday we have this assembly. So, of course, we're all sitting in this assembly, already bored out of our minds, not wanting anything to do with this school, because, shockingly, most people don't love school. Oh my gosh, brain opener here. Most people don't want to sit in a pep rally. They just don't. I'm sorry. I hate to break it to all you principals that love my videos, okay? All two of you. Miss Janet Jackson herself watching my videos. Most students are not trying to chill for an hour after school and listen to the pep rally, all right? It's just the truth of the matter. But whatever, we're sitting there, and Marissa's birthday is tomorrow, and trust me, everyone in the school knew because she felt the need to remind everyone every 15 minutes. Wow. Not like everyone else in the world has a birthday, Marissa. Nobody cares that you're turning 16 in 2 days. Literally nobody. Literally no one. But whatever, she's reminding everybody that her birthday's tomorrow, and we're getting near the end of the pep rally, and of course, most of us are like, ugh, sick, it's coming to an end, I can finally go home, it's the weekend, it's a little bit earlier than we would get out of school anyways, how awesome. And then, all of a sudden, the lights turn out, and a screen drops down from the middle of our gymnasium. Like I said, our school was a little bougie, and it starts playing a clip of Marissa cheerleading that year, and we're all like, wow, this is gonna be an absolute train wreck that nobody wants to watch. And it's like this super dramatic music. I mean, I'm not even kidding. Marissa is slapping these pom-poms together, and it's like, da-na-na-na-na. And then on screen pops, happy 16th birthday, Marissa. Her dad comes walking out. Everyone's like, oh my god, she's freaking out. And me and my friends are sitting here like, are we really turning this pep rally into happy birthday, Marissa? All right, whatever. Like, yeah, was I a little petty? Absolutely. Do I regret anything? Absolutely not. So whatever, they forced the entire assembly, half the school population that didn't ditch the assembly, to go outside, and sitting there in the parking lot with a big bow on it is a brand new white BMW. But what's this? Ashley already had a white BMW, and instead of being excited and happy that her father not only put together the entire school being here to witness her car, not only got the assembly to have a segment all about happy birthday to his daughter, she immediately bursts into tears and is yelling at her dad, "I can't have a white BMW. Ashley has a white BMW. It's the wrong color. It's the wrong car." That is right, ladies and gentlemen. In front of me is a 16-year-old girl crying that she got a brand new white BMW for her 16th birthday because her friend already had a white BMW. Excuse me, young lady. I will gladly take that car off your hands. Feel free to drop the keys in my hand. I love BMWs, and I would drive one in a heartbeat. In fact, one of the first things I bought with my YouTube money was a BMW because I loved them so much. So I'm witnessing this girl crying because she got a BMW. And I'm thinking, you know, the dad's going to lay down the law and be like, "Listen here, you spoiled little princess. You're not going to embarrass me in front of everybody," because everybody at this point is kind of looking at her like, "Oh my God, what a brat." But the dad immediately starts apologizing. Her dad is apologizing for buying her a BMW. What type of backwards, twisted world am I living in, ladies and gentlemen, when I'm witnessing a father apologize to a daughter for buying her the wrong car? What? What type of backwards life am I living? So the dad's apologizing, and I'm like, what type of backwards world are we living in? And the entire school is kind of watching this go down with just the idea of like, what in the world? Are you kidding me? If my parents bought me a brand new BMW and I whined that it was the wrong color and I couldn't drive it because my friend had one, I guarantee you, my parents would have boxed me up and shipped me to Colombia so I could work in a factory making iPhones, all right? Like, there is no way my parents are ever gonna let that slide. And in front of the whole school, her dad had to have been so embarrassed. Imagine buying a car at BMW, having this huge PowerPoint, and the next thing you know, she is crying and saying that it's the wrong car and that you're basically the worst dad in the history of the world because you're an idiot who got her the same car as her friend. Like, what in the world is going on? So whatever, the entire school is watching this go down. We're all dramatically embarrassed. Everyone's kind of having like this like cringe moment, cringing for her father. That's basically what's going down right now. And she's crying. She goes, "I don't even care. I'm going home." And gets in the car with her mom, who is consoling her, patting her on the back, being like, "It's okay, honey. Your dad didn't know. It's okay. We'll get this fixed. I'm sorry. You know what Marissa needed is a good slap in the face and some gratitude, okay? Like, sorry. Yeah, Ashley got the same car as you. You guys can live with it, okay? Come on. So anyways, I hopped on Twitter and sent out a little bit of a tweet kind of making fun of like whose kid is so spoiled that they cry at the sight of a new BMW. And I'm not even kidding you, within 20 minutes I get a DM from her, and she's basically saying that her dad is going to sue me unless I take down the tweet, and I'm getting reported to the school for cyberbullying. And I'm like, first of all, you can't prove I'm talking about you, Marissa, you idiot. Second of all, you're gonna sue me because I tweeted out that you're a little bit of a spoiled princess. You're kind of proving my point. So whatever, I just deleted the tweet because it wasn't worth my energy. But, you know, in the back of everyone's mind, everybody's kind of like, wow, Marissa's kind of a stuck-up little priss that no one wants to hang out with, because who in the world is going to cry over a brand new BMW? Marissa, that's who. And, anyways, Monday comes around, we go back into school, and sure enough, you know what pulls up in the parking lot, ladies and gentlemen? Not a white BMW, no, a brand new white Camaro. That's right, her father had gone out the same day and bought her a new car, which goes to show you, you don't have to be a good person, you just have to have a rich dad, and you don't have to be a good person ever, you know? Her dad, after getting embarrassed in front of the whole school, went out and got her a new car. That is right. Basically, moral of the story, Marissa, you're a bad person, that's not your real name, you can't prove this is about you if you're watching this, suck my tit, you suck. And, yeah, that's the time a spoiled girl cried over her new car and made her dad go get her a new one. I don't know what to tell you. I have a story today about a kid that definitely deserved everything that came to him. I've said it a couple times now, I went to a private school where some kids' parents definitely had some bands. I did go to a school with a couple of, like, famous people's kids. I'm not gonna name names or anything, because I just don't do that on this channel. But there were some people in my school that had a ton of money. And, you know, I grew up pretty normal. Like, my parents definitely aren't sending money to the Caymans every month. Or at all. I think the only money my
my parents have ever sent to the Caymans is when we were on a cruise one time. But like, other than that, you know, I lived a pretty normal childhood. But a lot of these kids had grown up around nothing but Gucci belts and like Louis Vuitton rattles. When they were a baby, their parents refused to use throwawayable diapers because that was a poor person thing and had liquid gold cast into their body every time they soiled themselves. And I learned from a pretty young age that certain people are just gonna flex stuff because they're deeply insecure. And something else that I learned at a young age is kids flexing is one of the lamest things ever because 9 times out of 10, it's just definitely not your money. Like, when you're in middle school, there is literally no way that you bought yourself a new iPhone. Mommy and daddy definitely did it for you. And at least in middle school, you could be like, oh, they're immature and dumb. But by the time you're in high school, you should basically know that flexing what mommy and daddy get in their bank account every month definitely does not make you look cool. It makes you look like you belong on a certain canoe made out of a feminine hygiene product, a douche canoe. And on the douche canoe, there was a bunch of people at my school. This hypothetical douche canoe full of people that flexed their parents' money. There was tons of people that did this. Like, the specific kid that the story is about was not the only person that would flex their parents' money way too much. But even in a school full of people doing it, this kid was known for being extremely obnoxious about the fact that his dad was some, like, crazy successful lawyer with a ton of money. He was constantly posting stuff on Snapchat, like, him holding a bunch of money and would make the caption, "Sorry, I don't speak poor people," or like, "Ugh, poor people are so disgusting." I'll never forget one time he posted on Snapchat a picture of a homeless dude on the side of the road with, "must suck to be so untalented." Like, was just really not a nice guy, constantly flexing his wealth. And I get it, man. Aha, screw poor people because my dad is rich. But I really don't understand flexing on Snapchat because the only people that you have added on Snapchat are people that you know, and when you go to a school full of rich kids, being rich is no longer that dope. Like, it's just another trait of any kid, like having, I don't know, eyes or arms. So if you don't have eyes and arms, that's when I guess you would be considered abnormal in this situation. Some kid out there is like, dang, I guess I really will just never be normal in Ryan's eyes. Real talk, this kid was always a giant douche about the fact that his parents had money. He would make fun of homeless people. He would belittle other people. I'm not even kidding you. He would walk around the hallways and call people by their parents' salaries. He would find out what job your parents did. Usually he would like ask or during a career day thing or whatever, he would find out. And then he would go Google what their average salary was and would walk around in like call people by their parents' salaries, which might be the douchiest thing ever. It's right up there with wearing a polo shirt with the collar popped, constantly calling everybody dog despite your obviously suburban origins, and most importantly, listening to nothing but Macklemore and Russ. So King Douchebag continues his tirade of just being an unlikable person. So I've set the scene for why this kid low-key deserved what came to him. I don't want you guys to think that I'm just a fan of somebody getting, like, roasted in front of the school for no reason. Yeah, this poor kid started crying in front of everyone, and I said, "What are you, Timmy, you little bitch? Wipe your tears off and get back out there and go again. Nobody's gonna take care of you, Tim." Like, nah, I don't like stuff like that, but every now and then somebody gets their comeuppance, and that's the greatest thing of all. So this kid is obviously a giant rich douche canoe, and we got a new girl at school, and we would get new kids, like, relatively often, because whenever anyone would come to town, they would put their kid at our school. I don't know why. We were just like one of those schools that would get a lot of new kids. So this new girl comes to town, and I'm not gonna lie, on a scale of 1 to 10, she was a solid 10. She still is. I follow her on Instagram to this day, and I can firmly say that she is in fact a cutie pie. Whatever, this new girl comes to class, and douche canoe Mr. Richie the kid instantly is like, "Oh, she's super hot. She's mine." And he claims that she is his in the middle of class where she can hear him in front of all these other dudes. He's like, "If any of you guys try to date her, you can't. She's mine. Oh my god, I'm gonna wow her. Like, aha, she's gonna be my girl." And this is right in front of this new girl. Well, not in front of her, like a couple desks behind her, but definitely loud enough where she can hear it. And she turns around and looks at, like, this douchey rich kid who's wearing way too much cologne and definitely thinks he has got the "I'm the sexiest man in the world" appeal, when it really is more of a I look like I played too much League of Legends appeal. So she looks back at him and he's like, oh, hey, baby, what you looking at? And she's like, ugh, you're calling me, but I would never date anyone that looks as gross as you. And he immediately gets all defensive, which is what every dude with like a super big ego does. Because most of the time, people who go out of their way to be super cocky and flex on you are super insecure. So whenever anybody makes fun of them, they low-key have a panic attack. So when he gets called out and everybody starts laughing at him, he decides that the only logical response is to insult the girl he was just flirting with. So he's like, oh, I claimed you just to make you feel better. None of these other dudes were interested anyways. And I don't know why, but watching people get their comeuppance is my favorite. So I raise my hand because I haven't said anything so far. And I'm like, I'm interested. And the girl smiled at me. She's like, oh, okay. See, somebody was before you claimed me. I'm not a piece of meat to claim, which I mean, hey, good for you. Tell them off. Stand up for yourself. Yell at the spoiled kid being spoiled. And at this point, he thinks that he's like offended her. He thinks that he's just misspoke. Obviously, he's pressed because everybody's laughed at him, but he still thinks there's a way to save this and like look better than anyone. So he looks at me and says, shut up, and says what my dad's salary is for his job, which was supposed to convey like an insult, as if, you know, I was supposed to like start crying that my dad has a certain amount of money he gets paid for his job. No! Not my dad's pay stubs, dude. Stop. But whatever. He calls me like by my number, and so I just like laugh at it. And then he looks back at her and is like, you don't know how it works around here, and starts bragging about how rich his dad is and how he has like a Ferrari and his house is huge, and he's like probably the richest kid in the school. So he understands that he offended her and he didn't mean to like offend her by saying that she was his and that no one else could hit on her. Like, he doesn't own her, he knows that women have rights. I love that he had to clarify that too. He's talking to a girl. He's like, yeah, I do know women can vote, by the way. So he's laying on the talk by trying to tell her that, no, it's okay that I was a douchebag because my dad's rich, which surprisingly does not go over very well with the girl with the brain. I just don't understand what a lot of these dudes are thinking too. Like, girls don't like dudes with the personality of like Versace cologne. They just don't. I'm sorry. I mean, don't get me wrong. You'll eventually settle with somebody that's going to use you for all your money and pretend that they love you and low-key have kids with your boss, but if you continue to just be a giant jerk, that's kind of what you get. That's the trade-off. People that are jerks marry people that are jerks, and people that are nice marry people that are nice. It's just the setup for the rules. And the girl very, very slickly, almost with a flick of the hair to dismiss all annoyance that has been in her face now, is like, I don't really care how much money you make. Sorry, I'm not that shallow. And the kid is like flabbergasted at the fact that this girl is not impressed by the fact that her or his dad has money. And he starts telling her that, like, oh, obviously she wasn't his type then because she's a moron, and how he thinks that like girls like her are really idiotic to turn down guys like him because he could take care of them, which is always the move. If you want a girl to like you, start insulting them after they reject you. It definitely doesn't make you look desperate or, you know, like you have no idea how to interact with women. None of that. And so at this point, the girl looks pretty fed up, and I'm not gonna lie, being the new kid is scary enough, but coming in and roasting some dude definitely takes some cojones the size of Philip Rivers. So she looks at him as he's insulting her, saying that she's a moron, and is like, no, what's idiotic is claiming a girl that has never spoken to you at all and doing loud enough so she can hear you. Maybe if you want girls to talk to you, maybe you should stop treating them like you own them and start treating them like they have feelings. And the entire class is like, oh, because everybody just hated this dude. And just when we think it can't get worse, and she's like, oh, and one more thing, nobody cares if you have money, because I bet you your dad is disappointed in you and wouldn't leave it to you anyways. And at this point, it's not like a super great insult, don't get me wrong, it's pretty mean. It doesn't sound that great in retrospect, like it's not the greatest roast ever spoken into existence, don't get it twisted. But you gotta understand, for a kid that did nothing but talk about how much he hated poor people, watching him get basically fisted in front of the class was pretty entertaining. So homeboy is now grabbing his hand like that one Arthur meme from a year ago, where he just looks like he's about to let loose on everybody, and he's all embarrassed and he's all hot in the face, and he's like, well, whatever, at least at the end of the day, like, I still have money. Like, you might not like me, but I still win at the end of the day because I get to go home in a Rolls Royce. Which, I mean, kind of fair enough, low-key. Like, in retrospect, he kind of has a point. We can hate him all he wants, but he still gets to go home to the mansion. But after that, the post making fun of poor people on Snapchat
Snapchat stopped. He definitely stopped thinking that he owned the place, and he stopped dressing like, I don't know, you know when old people's houses are decorated and it's just really gaudy and tacky and just not vibing? Yeah, that's kind of what he would dress like. So after that, he switched it up a little bit and overall became a nice person, because every now and then your bully just needs to get roasted in front of everybody and dramatically embarrassed for them to have a life-changing experience.
So basically, the school that this person goes to has like one of the best high school bands in the city, which, I mean, it's not a giant city from what they told me. Like, it's a decently large city. You've probably heard of it, but it's not like, you know, world famous. And so because the band is relatively important, it's something where like parents really want their kids to be involved, because when it comes time to like apply to college, being like, oh, I was in one of the best high school bands in the country, apparently helps you get into college. I don't really know how Harvard thinks you're a better person because you can play the trombone, but whatever, apparently some people think that. So a lot of parents would like just sign their kids up for this band, and the kids just wouldn't be very musically inclined, you know, or really care about it much. They were kind of just there to, you know, exist and fill in the spot and get it to look good on college applications. And the band teacher was pretty understanding about how like kids needed this for college applications. So he got around it by basically making like an upper division band and a lower division band, which basically was the kids who just like were signed up to look good on college were put in the lower division. And he had another name for it so it didn't sound as insulting. It was like, you know, competition band and like spirit band, like stuff like that, to make it still look good on college resumes. But for the most part, if you didn't care or you weren't musically talented, you just kind of kept your mouth shut and stayed in like the spirit band so you could look good, and you didn't cause problems or try to like ruin the competition band, because those were the kids who really cared about it, which in my opinion seems like a fair system. You get the credit for being in the band, but like you don't ruin anything for the kids who actually really care. But because this competition band was, you know, pretty good and the city didn't exactly have a ton of stuff going on, it was pretty common for like people to actually come to football games and stuff to watch the band, which sounds crazy to me. Like, I grew up in Las Vegas, so the idea that people actually want to go to a high school football game on a Friday night is pretty foreign to me. Like, there's always something better to do in Vegas, but I guess if you live in a place where there's not a crap ton else going on, I can understand why you'd probably be like, oh, let's go to the football game and watch this band play, I guess. I don't know. I'm also just not a ginormous fan of, like, band music. Like, I've never been like, hey, yo, bruh, let's get some of that high school marching band mix up in this place and turn up. But maybe that's just me. Regardless, because people would, like, come watch the band and it was kind of something that was important, you know, and like whenever they would perform at the football field, all the parents would be like, oh my god, the band's amazing. There was one girl though who was in the lower band, like the JV band, and she was one of those girls that thought she could sing, you know, like she'd be like, oh my god, like fine, I guess I'll sing it, but like I'm not good. Amazing grace, and like try so hard, you know, covering their ears, like doing all that type of stuff. She was one of those girls you was like, yeah, I'm kind of a singer, I'm not that good though, you know. Oh yeah, syncing up my voice. Like one of those people. I think we all know them, the choir kids that just start randomly trying to sing High School Musical during lunch, and it's like, yo dog, that was a movie. This isn't real life. Please sit down before I'm forced to give you a swirly. You know, I don't want to have to do it, but if you keep singing High School Musical in the cafeteria and trying to get us to cause a flash mob, I'm going to have to do what I got to do. Regardless, she thought that she was amazing, and that's what matters. And if you've ever seen American Idol, you know that for whatever reason, people are very defensive of their singing. Like, I feel like most skills, people are pretty honest about, you know? If you have a white belt in karate, you're not going to ask to do, like, a karate display in front of your high school football team, you know? Because you're aware of the fact that you're just not good at it yet. But if American Idol has taught us anything, it's that people just don't think that they're bad at singing, you know? And this is coming from somebody like, I can't sing, and that's okay. That's fine. If I ever make music, I gotta use autotune. And that's okay. I can't change the fact that I sound like a raspy whale. And that's fine. I'm not trying to go sing the national anthem in front of an NBA game. So this girl who's a horrible singer and constantly trying to get attention for her singing finds out that coming up, they're gonna be playing against the other biggest high school in town, in that over like 2,000 people are planning to be in attendance because the game has sold out, and the school that they're playing at is a private school with a bigger stadium, but they've asked this band to play because they're known for being so good locally, right? So she finds out, and at the time, the competition band started with somebody trying to sing, you know, like there was like a little vocalist part. And immediately, this girl that can't sing is like, I deserve the solo. And the second somebody opens anything with I deserve blank, it immediately just rubs me the wrong way because this is a sad fact of life. Nobody really owes you anything, you know? Like, you're not owed anything. You don't really deserve anything. Other than, like, human respect and decency, you know? Human rights you're entitled to. But nobody owes you, like, singing in front of 1,000 people. Like, you don't deserve anything in that regard, you know? If you got the talent, sure, you can earn it. But, like, oh, I deserve to just sing by default. Everybody else who wants to sing, no, they don't deserve it. I do. I deserve it over everyone else in this school. That type of attitude is just kind of toxic, you know? Like, it's just very entitled to assume that you are by default the best singer and you deserve it. So, regardless, this girl is convinced she deserves it. So she goes to the band director, and the band director is obviously like, nah, I hear you singing during class and you have the pipes of someone just not very talented, so thank you for the offer, but no, we will not be needing your services to sing. And she just starts losing it, saying that she's given her heart and soul to the band, and all she's asking is to sing this one time. And I'm gonna let this in on a little secret too. When something is called competition blank, it doesn't matter how hard you worked, bro. Like, you just don't deserve it, man. I'm sorry. If you're a 55-year-old man and you're like, every day for 8 hours, I throw the football. Why won't the Colts make me the quarterback? It's because you're just not good. It's a competition. You know, this ain't the pity party band. This isn't like hard work band. No, this is the competition band, dog. So the band director just tells her no and basically says, tough stuff. You're not good enough at singing to like actually be the lead singer in this performance, which whatever, call it mean, call it what you want. But imagine somebody coming to you and saying that they deserve to be like the lead of the competition band that you work hard on because they work hard. Like, not because they're talented, not because they're good, but just because, you know, they show up. And the best part about this is the person who sent me this is like, she did not work hard. She never came to extra practices. She never came to like extra team meetings for team bonding, nothing. She only ever showed up in class. So it's not even like that's a true statement. So whatever, she goes home and tells her mom. And her mom, of course, is just as entitled to the daughter because where do you think she gets it from, bro? Like, you never meet a bad kid and then meet their parents and go, dang, I wonder where this person became a bad kid from. Like, usually the apple don't fall too far from the tree. You know what I'm saying? So, obviously, the mom is basically like, how dare you tell my daughter that she's not a good enough singer, and starts raising an issue with the administration, like the principal, the deans and stuff, and basically says that she's willing to press a lawsuit on the school because of like the competition slash spirit band thing or spirit band thing, because it's discriminatory based upon like a class service, because at the time band was a class, you know? So technically they weren't really supposed to have like a good and bad type of situation. And she's basically like, I'm considering a lawsuit, da-da-da-da-da. And so the school is like, look, you gotta make her the lead singer for this little thing because we can't handle a lawsuit. Schools don't like to be sued, which, you know, I understand nobody likes a lawsuit. But at the same time, this entitled Karen was really about to, like, ruin the band program for everybody just so her daughter can sing. So the band director is like, fine, your daughter can sing. And all week when they're practicing, this girl is tone deaf. But for whatever reason, dude, she is convinced that she's hype. And nobody's telling her how bad she sounds because everybody's pissed that she has to sing in the first place. Like, it's not a secret that her mom had come in and pulled some strings to get her behind it, so nobody in the band was really trying to, like, help her out and tell her that she needed to sound better. They're all hyping her up, telling her she sounds great, and she sounds awful. And the band director's not saying anything because it's not even like he wants her to be the singer, dude. He got forced to do this, so he's just keeping his mouth shut, like, fine, I'll stay out of the way. So whatever, the time comes, and, like, this private school has a nice little football. It's not a stadium. That's probably a little intense, but 2,000 people are crammed into, like, the bleachers slash the seats to watch this game, dude. And the halftime comes, and the band goes out, and sure enough, this girl starts singing, and it sounds god-awful because she just can't sing. And I don't understand what this girl's mom was trying to do, dude. Like, you're gonna help your daughter by just making her embarrass herself in front of all of her peers? That seems like the exact opposite of what you want. Like, if I have a kid, right, and he's awful at singing, and he asks me to let him sing in front of people, I'm gonna have to sit him down and go, look, son, you can't sing. And we're not talking about an 8-year-old here. We're talking about, like, a 17-year-old, somebody close to adulthood. Friends don't let friends, like, embarrass themselves this badly, regardless of whether or not they're your kid. So the daughter is singing, and it's obviously terrible, and it's bad enough where everybody starts booing. And, like, if you could imagine having 2,000 people boo you after thinking that you're a great singer, that don't feel too hot. So she finishes the song and, like, runs off embarrassed, you know, and her mom is, like, in the crowd, you can hear her on the field yelling at people to stop booing her daughter, which, you know, obviously just makes people boo more, because the only thing people hate more than a bad singer is a Karen telling them to pretend to like a bad singer. And honestly, overall, it was just an L of the situation. And to make matters worse, the next year, the Karen, like, ruined it for everybody. The band teacher ended up starting to teach only, like, AP music theory and made band, the competition band, strictly an extracurricular activity, so that he really could only pick who could be on it and who couldn't be. So, like, all the kids that had gotten the benefit of being in the band on their resume because they just kept their mouth shut and let the competition band do what the competition band did, had it ruined for them because of this Karen, and so that really sucks.
My cousin is from a douchey rich family. He's never been told no in his life. He has a massive problem hearing anything other than yes. Like, one time, our other little cousins got iPods and he ended up stealing from them on Christmas. He's just not a very good person. And because his parents have never told him no, his sense of entitlement has never gone anywhere. And he's, like, around the same age I am. He's a whole adult now. And being a spoiled brat stops being cute after, like, I don't know. When you learn how to talk, once you can learn how to talk and can say stupid stuff, being a spoiled brat is not cute. And he's gone well past that stage, all right? Everything out of his mouth might sound terrible, but he's still talking. And usually on Easter, we get together with the extended family at my grandma's house, and she does this really cool Easter egg hunt where all the little cousins get to run around and get candy, and it's a good time. And usually she gives the older kids some money. It's, like, not a lot, usually. I think last year she gave every kid over the age of 14, like, $10. But it's super sweet, and my grandma has a big heart. It's not any reason anybody goes to Easter. Like, nobody's ever super hyped to wake up in the morning at 8 a.m. and go to grandma's for $10. But it makes her feel better to give it to us, and the family has a great time, and it, like, you know, it's just something that happens at Easter. Except this year, my grandma, who's an old lady, really can't be around people because this coronavirus is going around the planet taking out boomers like a Clorox wet wipe. So I do live near my grandma that I usually spend Easter with. She's like 2 blocks away. I haven't seen her in a few weeks. I did teach her how to FaceTime a little bit so I can like check up on her, but I haven't wanted to go see her because I've been sick and the last thing I want to do is be responsible for giving grandma corona, right? I didn't know what I had, so better not risk it. You don't want to be the dude at the funeral who's like, okay, I might have accidentally been responsible here, but let's just bond. It's not going to work out very well. But regardless, I kind of live near her, and I get a call at like 1 p.m. yesterday, and it's my grandma. And I answer it. I'm like, hey. And she says, hi, will you come here? Your cousin's here, and he won't leave. He says that I owe him his Easter money, but I don't have any, and he won't leave. He's standing at the door. He's trying to get in. Like, he's in the backyard now checking all the windows. Can you come get him to leave? And I was in like the middle of a nap, so I sleepily respond like, sure. So I go over to my grandma's house, not really knowing what to expect to find. It's not every day you get woken up from a nap from your grandma in quarantine saying that your cousin is trying to break into the house for $10. But hey, I had nothing else going on Easter, and it's supposed to be about family or whatever, so I guess I gotta go stop a grandma break-in, because some people just never learn not to rob your grandma, I guess. I didn't realize that was a life lesson that my cousin needed to learn. So I, like, walk down there. Like I said, it's like 2 blocks. I get over there, and sure enough, my cousin is banging on the door saying, let me in. I want to see you. And I walk up, I'm like, dude, what is going on? And he basically says, oh, hey, Ryan, you know how we usually get money for Easter? And I'm like, yeah. And he says, well, since no one's coming over for Easter, I just figured that she would give me what everybody normally gets. And I'm like, what makes you think that? Easter is canceled, so you get everyone's money? That's just the default? And he's like, yeah, but now she won't let me in to get it. She says she doesn't have the money, but I know she has it in there. So I guess I can understand the confusion, but I tell him, look, you're scaring grandma. Can you please relax and not try to break into her house? And he's like, well, you know, it is my God-given right to get that Easter money. I'm like, yeah, not really. That's not how Easter money works. Most people don't get any Easter money. In fact, most people, once they get too old to look for Easter eggs, don't get anything. So how about you chill? And he's like, well, I mean, you usually get it too. I'm willing to split it with you. As if, you know, he's just going to blackmail me. All of a sudden, I'm going to come up and be like, whoa, you're going to split this money with me? In that case, and like pull out a crowbar and start trying to break into my grandma's house. Shockingly, I don't need the $10 that my grandma gives me for Easter, like badly enough to break into her house. Is it nice? Sure. Will it pay for Taco Bell? Sure. Am I gonna terrify my grandmother by making her think her home's being invaded? Nah. All right, that might be where I'm drawing the line personally, but I guess that's just my personal morals, and the rest of my family doesn't care at all, because when I said no, he went,
well, I'm getting in either way, so you might as well just go home. And I'm like, dog, I'm not gonna let you break into grandma's house. So he goes back to, like, banging on the door, and the door comes open, and the screen door is locked. And my grandma's sitting there. She's like, you need to go home. I don't have any money for you. And he starts screaming at her about how she's the worst grandma ever, and all he wants is his Easter money. And she's, like, saying really mean things. And I'm not a fan of people being mean to my grandma. So, like, I go up to him, and I grab him from behind. I put my arms under his shoulder, and I, like, try to pull him backwards away from the door, kind of more towards the driveway. And I guess at this point, he'd worked up his adrenaline from trying to break into his own grandma's house. Because what happens next is my cousin pulls a 180 as if he's a skater going down a stair set and, like, tries to swing on me. And here's the thing, most of the family on this grandma's side is pretty short. Like, my dad's side of the family isn't super tall, my mom's side is tall, like, that's where my height comes from. So my cousin, even though he's around the same age, doesn't really understand logic in the fact that he's like 5'4 and I'm 6'2 and we're kind of built the same, so this isn't gonna go well. So he turns around and tries to swing on me as if I'm the bad guy for trying to prevent him from breaking into my grandma's house. So here I am throwing fisticuffs with my cousin in front of my grandma's house while she's watching through the screen door, horrified because her grandkids are swinging on each other. And my cousin is screaming in my ear weird stuff about how, like, I wasn't a good cousin when I was little. Which, I mean, I guess true, but, like, I don't understand how that's relevant when you're fighting me while trying to break into grandma's house. And I'm not really, like, trying to fight the kid. I'm not trying to swing on him. He's just kind of following me around the driveway while I, like, try to back up. And every time he gets close, I'll, like, push him away, but I don't want to fight him. And so my grandma is now outside of the screen door, like, watching us, yelling, stop, stop, stop. And that's when my cousin just goes too far. Like I said, I haven't really been trying to fight him. All I've done is, like, push him and wrestle him a little bit. I don't want to fight my cousin. That's not fun. And then he turns around and he spits at my grandma, like, towards her. And at this point, I'm like, dog, all right, I've been nice. You've tried to break in. You've done all this. Now you're spitting at her. She doesn't want you to get hurt. But at this point, listen, you're family. I'm allowed to beat you up. So I go up to him after he spits at my grandma, and I tackle him, and I hit him, like, once or twice. It's not a lot. It's enough to let him know that, like, don't spit at grandma. And now he's crying. He's saying how I'm the worst, and I'm a terrible person, and he's gonna tell his mom and dad all about this. Like, yes, my uncle being mad at me, an adult, is really gonna hurt my feelings. I don't care. What? And also, your dad's gonna call me and say, you hit my son, and when I say, yeah, well, he spit at your mom, he's gonna take your side? Probably because his parents are terrible, but that's another story. So, whatever. He gets up, and I walk over to my grandma to make sure he's okay. Because he says, you know, he's crying, he's done, he's going to tell his dad. Whatever, I only need to hit you twice anyways. I don't want to fight my cousin. So I walk over to my grandma to make sure she's okay, because I'm fine. I mean, it's not like it really hurt that bad. He hits like a girl. But as I'm talking to my grandma, making sure he's okay, I don't know if this kid crawled up on me like the last zombie of the round or what, but he's on the ground, and he bites the shit out of my calf. Like, hard. Really, really hard. So I, like, scream, because I didn't expect a human teeth imprint on my calf because he bit me so hard, and I turn, and this is really bad. I kick him in the head because he scared me. He bit my ankle, so when I turned, I just kicked. I didn't know it was there. I wasn't taking chances. What if it would have been a tiger or something? I've seen Tiger King. Those things are ferocious. I'm not taking chances. And when I kick him, he gets up and he's like, this is why I always hated you. Your family's so... And just crying. I can't even understand what he's saying. But something along the lines of, my family's poor. That's why we suck. He's always hated me. That type of stuff, you know. As if it's my fault that this grown man just bit me on the calf and is now crying like a little baby over the fact that there was a consequence. I don't know what you expect to happen. Call me a scientist here. If you bite somebody on the calf, they might hit you back. Just saying. So he freaks out and decides that he's had enough because my grandma tells him to go home. So he, like, angrily runs like a girl over to his Mercedes and hops in and goes home. And I look at my grandma, I'm like, are you okay? And she says, yeah, you know, he just came over and he knocked on the door and I answered. I thought he just wanted to see me. So I was talking to him through the screen door and he says, do you have my money? And I didn't know what he was talking about. And then he said that he knows that I have the Easter money for everybody, so why don't I just give it to him? And I'm like, okay, well, what'd you say? She says no, and then once she said no, he started trying to, like, open the door and come inside, was checking every window, and that's when she called me. So I guess my cousin is just nuts. I don't even know why it's so important. Like, he drove off in a Mercedes. Clearly, I don't think you need the $20 that grandma was gonna give you. Yeah, so that's how my Easter went. Hopefully your guys' was less eventful. My grandma is okay. I didn't touch her, by the way. I made sure of that. So, yeah, my Easter was very peaceful until my cousin left a bite print on my calf. It wasn't expecting how I expected to get anything on Easter, but, like, I didn't find any Easter eggs, so now I find a reason to go to the hospital and make sure that I don't have any, like, rabies or anything. I don't know what my cousin has in his mouth. Anyways, guys, hopefully you guys had a good Easter. I know this story's a little bit shorter. I just don't really want to stretch it. I fought my cousin. That's all you need to know. Before I forget, I did get a call later that day from my uncle where he yelled at me and basically said that I was wrong to beat up his son, but it really doesn't matter to me, because like, it doesn't matter if it's wrong, dude. You're my uncle. I really don't care. I don't. This story takes place in a summer camp when I was like 10 or 11 years old. You know, my parents had to work a lot during the summer, and whenever my grandparents didn't want to watch me because I was a handful, they would send me to like this summer camp thing at a rec center that was pretty chill. It was pretty fun. There was never too much drama there, of course. It was basically just a bunch of kids hanging out all day during the summer, and it was better than being at, you know, a grandma's house, like watching old TV shows all day, I'm not gonna lie. Whenever I used to stay with my grandmas during the summer, there would be some pretty weird stuff that would go on. Like, they would force me to help them act out, like, these 60 mystery shows. I was just not a fan. So, summer camp was pretty chill with me. I vibed with it. It was much better to hang out with kids all day because when you're a kid, you just get along better with kids. And the one thing that I will say about a summer camp at a rec center in a major city is there's a wide variety of kids that pull up, you know? I'm not really sure if, like, everybody that went to this rec center has good mental health histories or like hasn't gone insane ever since I was 10 or 11 because it's the last time I saw them, but there were definitely some interesting people that would make every day entertaining. For example, there was this kid that could fart and burp on command, and he would burp the alphabet while farting at the same time. And I know what some of you are thinking, oh my god, that's gross, that's ridiculous. And you might think that, but 11-year-old me thought it was the funniest thing on the planet, and I basically thought he had a superpower, you know? Like, it was up there with Spider-Man for me. Sure, you can have super strength and swing on webs, or you could be able to fart and burp on command at the same time. That's pretty impressive. There were some other characters, you know, it was like some kids that would always fight with the counselors who were also just 16-year-old kids. It was kind of a train wreck. It was really 16-year-old kids watching 10-year-old kids all day, but like one 16-year-old for every, you know, 12, 10-year-olds. So they're obviously outnumbered, and the amount of people that were just weird in this camp that would do weird stuff was entertaining to say the least. So I liked being around it. Everything's pretty normal for the first couple of weeks of summer, and then one day we're like outside in this grassy area, and by the grassy area is where new kids would pull up and get dropped off, or kids would get dropped off, and I was there pretty early because my parents had to work, so it's maybe like 8 in the morning, and most cars that would pull up and drop kids off at this like rec center summer camp, you know, or like Fords or Toyotas, like normal cars, definitely not something you see. And as I'm sitting here, I see a Rolls Royce park in the parking lot, like right by the drop-off center. And I didn't know what a Rolls Royce was at the time. 10-year-old me was not like, oh my god, that's a Phantom. But you could just tell it was a nice car. You know, it just has this aura about it that lets you know that whoever is driving it is important. I'm pretty sure whoever was driving the car had a monocle, like that's how bougie it was, and I've never understood monocles, okay? Why would you pay more money for half of glasses? Like, monocles should really be half expensive as glasses, so it's weird to me that rich people would want to flex the fact that they only have glasses on one of their eyes. But whatever, this Rolls Royce pops out, and out hops this kid that just walks with the swagger of somebody that's fired 87 people. Like, this dude definitely goes to his dad's company's barbecues and just fires people that make crappy potato salad. Like, he just walks with attitude. And so he has this dude in a suit who gets out of the car with him, walks him up, and like checks him in. And the entire time this kid is just snootily looking around at everybody else, us, you know, in the field playing and whatever, and he's like got this snooty look of somebody that just thinks that they're better than you. You know when somebody gives you a look and it's just dismissive and rude and you can instantly tell that they think that you're a moron? That's the look that this kid is giving everybody. Anyways, this kid gets all checked in and he walks over and he like reaches out his hand to shake our hand. Keep in mind, we're like 10 or 11, you know, so everybody kind of looks at him weird, and he says, well, I'm not going to say his real name just because I don't know. I just always change the names in these stories. I'm going to name him Reginald, because that just sounds like the type of kid that eats $700 mustard and, like, wants to punch you in the face anytime anyone mentions anything that even sounds vaguely poor. Like, the dollar store! And he just has an involuntary reaction where he punches you because he hates poor people. Like, that's the type of air he gives off. So he comes over, and he reaches out and shakes her hand. He's like, hello, I'm Reginald, and my mother wants me to know what the normal class is like, so she's making me come here in the summer. And when you meet someone, just a general tip, saying that, like, my mom wants me to know the lower class, so I'll hang out with you friends. It's like, it's just not a very good way of, like, you know, making friends. So, whatever, everybody's like, hey, nice to meet you, Reginald, because kids honestly aren't very rude at first. Like, in retrospect, this kid was being a jerk, but, you know, everybody's just talking to him. And one of the kids who's, like, hanging out in our little group, whose name was Freddy, and he was pretty cool, and he, like, really liked cars. He knew what the car was, so he's like, oh my god, is that a Rolls Royce? Like, that's so cool. Oh, is it awesome to ride in, you know? And this kid gets this, like, smirk on his face. And this is when everybody realizes that we're not gonna like this kid. He looks at Freddy in the face, who is complimenting his car and being like, wow, it's so cool. I bet you it's fun to ride. And he looks at him and goes, yeah, but you'll probably never be able to afford anything like that anyways, so it's not like it matters. Bro, at 11 years old, this man is claiming that Freddy's never gonna be able to afford anything. How in the world do you know what anyone's gonna do at 11? At 11, bro, everyone probably thought that I was gonna end up, like, filling gas in cars in New Jersey, and now I'm a YouTuber. Crazy stuff happens sometimes. I mean, I was eating glue. Like, I can't be surprised that people didn't expect much from me, but what I'm saying is, this homeboy telling an 11-year-old that he'll never afford a nice car is crazy. And it also shows what his parents are like, you know, like, now remember, son, when you meet poor people, you have to, make fun of them and tell them that their dreams are stupid, so that way they never get any ideas. And it wasn't even like we were in a poor neighborhood, you know? Like, Freddy did not strike me as a kid that was scrounging for table scraps. He just seemed like a normal kid. Oh, yes, you middle-class people are morons. Like, yeah, okay. Am I ever gonna own a Rolls Royce? No, it's cool. But if I'm complimenting your car and just being nice, you don't have to tell me that I'm poor back. Like, that's just a little unnecessary. So, Reginald, immediately is kind of on the crap list. Nobody really vibes with him because he's just kind of mean. And any time that he has any excuse to bring up the fact that he's better than us, he would. Like, the first day, again, we're eating lunch and he's just kind of standing in the corner by himself like a weirdo. Like, only weird people eat lunch in the corner, for sure. I used to. So he's standing in the corner eating lunch alone like a weirdo, and, like, he's just giving me dirty looks, which is weird. I haven't even said more than, like, hi to this kid, and he's just staring at me, giving me this death stare that's like, I don't know who you are, but I don't like you. Not a fan of your face. I hope it gets hit by a car. Like, he's just giving me this dirty look, and he's in the corner by himself eating, so I'm just eating with my friends, and I'm giving him dirty looks back, because I'm not gonna lie, even 11-year-old me was like, I don't take no disrespect out here on the streets! It might have been a rec center summer camp, but that's as close to the streets as I ever got, so it was pretty serious to me. So, I'm giving him dirty looks back, and one of the camp counselors, who's like 16, mind you, walks over to him and is like, oh, are you, like, eating lunch alone? That's so sad. Here, come with me. And walks him over to our table with, like, me and my summer camp friends, right? And is like, can he sit with you? And, obviously, I'm not gonna tell this, like, camp counselor, like, nah, man, this kid smells like ball sack and vinegar dressing. Like, of course, I'm gonna be like, yeah, sure, I'm 11, I don't really know a lot. Plus, sharing is caring or whatever. I think I remembered more Barney episodes when I was younger than I do now, so I'm sure some part of me was, like, just trying to be a little bit of a good person. So, he sits down, and I think I was eating, like, some reheated pizza or something, which I will say, as Mac Miller once said, Kool-Aid and frozen pizza bangs. I warm my up personally just because frozen pizza, I don't know, you get sick of it after a while. But I'm eating some pizza and he looks at it, he's like, oh, is that American pizza? And he says it as if, you know, American pizza is disgusting, which, say what you want, but Americans know how to make fat, disgusting junk food. Okay, you can diss Americans for being obese, that's cool, but us Americans know how to make some pretty mean food, and Americanized pizza is good. Domino's bangs for a reason, you know? That's just the reality of the situation. So, I'm like, yeah, it's American pizza. Because I'm 11, what other type of pizza would I have? Do you really think my parents are hopping on a private jet, flying to Italy, picking up a pizza for the boys to eat at, you know, summer camp tomorrow? Of course it's American pizza. Where the hell would I get any other type of pizza? So, I say, yes, it's American pizza. And he looks at me and is like, Yeah, when I went to Italy, I had, like, real Italian pizza. And once you get used to that, this, like, disgusting cheap American stuff just isn't that good. We're at 10 minutes, so I'm gonna have to ask you nicely, too. If you're enjoying the video so far, if you could press the like button and comment, like, I don't know, what you think of this douchey rich kid so far, I would really appreciate it. It just helps the video do better, and, I'm really trying to hit, like, 2 mil subs on both channels, so if you could like and comment, I'd appreciate it. It just helps me do better. Which, first of all, Reginald, nobody cares that you went to Italy, bro. Good for you. Congratulations. What did you do? See some museums and stuff? That's great. Trust me, I want to go to Italy one day too. But I'm 11. Do you even fully appreciate Italy when you're 11? Like, your mom's like, oh my god, these stairs are 700 years old. You're like, well, I'm 10. I have no concept of time. I have no idea if that's a long time because I'm 10. That's 70 of me. Like, you can't understand, like, you can't understand it as good when you're 10, you know? So he's trying to flex on me and my American pizza. And I'm gonna say it. You know what? Apparently, Italian pizza's sauce isn't as sweet and their dough isn't as thick. So I'm gonna say it. I like American pizza. And if that makes me terrible, then guess what? At least I'm terrible in the best country on earth. USA. USA. So whatever. Reginald is lecturing me about how apparently I'm a disgusting American for eating American pizza or whatever. And so, even back then, my tolerance for bullcrap has never been extremely high. So I look at him while he's telling me about Italy, and I just go, can you shut up? And his face just, like, turns. He's like, what did you just say to me? You know, all snooty as if he's superior. And I'm like, can you shut up? And he's like, who do you think you are to talk to me this way? Which, listen, that might be a good line when you're like a 45-year-old and a 10-year-old tells you to shut up. But when you're both 10, who do you think you are is just a really crappy line because it's, I don't know, we're both kids and you're talking a lot, so I'm telling you to shut up. It's not that complicated. So he's being all sassy. He's like, I'm going to tell on you. Which, keep in mind, everybody running the summer camp is like 16 and doesn't care if you tell people to shut up. So I tell him, go for it, bro. I don't care. So he, you know, does this, like, slither away. You know what he kind of reminds me of, honestly, in the way he moves and, like, the way he acted? The bad guy from the first Monsters, Inc., Randall. Like, the slithery little crap head that would change his color based upon what was going on. That's who he low-key acted like. And I'm just saying, if your nearest personality twin is a Disney villain that was, like, trying to kidnap a child, maybe you should rework your personality because it might not be that good. This kid never got the memo. So he goes up to these, like, people running the summer camp, and he snitches on me, which, you know, as I say, have said multiple times in my videos, in the infamous words of Little Skies, I ain't folding under pressure, I ain't switching for no hoe, I ain't talking to no cop, and I ain't telling on my bros. And sure enough, he snitches. He told on the bros. Violated rule number one. And he says that I told him to shut up. But as he's telling them that I told him to shut up, he starts crying. Keep in mind, listen, we're young. But like, bruh, if you can't handle the heat, get out of the kitchen. How are you gonna call me a stupid fat American and then cry like a little baby whenever I tell you to shut up? I'm just saying, that seems a little BS to me. So he's crying, and obviously every girl-like person in charge is now like, oh my god, look at this little kid crying, it's so sad. And I see him turn and point at me, like dead at me. And all the girls look all disappointed, you know, and they come over to me, they're like, why would you tell him to shut up? You know he's new. That probably really hurt his feelings. So they tell me that I need to apologize because, like, it's against the rules to bully people and, you know, I have to be more considerate of other people's feelings. And I try to explain myself and go, well, he's making fun of us for being poor and eating American pizza. Like, I just told him to shut up because I don't care that he's been to Italy. I don't understand why that's mean. And I'm not gonna apologize. And they're like, well, you need to apologize. And I put my foot down. I'm like, no, I don't care that this 16-year-old is bossing me around. I'm not even kidding. One of these girls that used to teach me has slid into my DM since I became a YouTuber. So there's no way that I'm listening to them. Like, dog, you guys are not old enough compared to me to tell me what to do. So no, I'm not gonna apologize. If this kid's being a jerk, he deserved to get told to shut up. So they basically are like, well, if you don't apologize, then we're calling your parents and you can't come back for 2 days because you're breaking the bullying rules. And I'm like, if that's what you got to do, that's what you got to do, because I'm not apologizing. And since then, I've learned something that you got to do in life sometimes. Sometimes it's easier to apologize, even if you're not in the wrong, to just, like, make life easier, okay? But I was not going to apologize to this kid for saying what I said, because honestly, I'd tell it again. If he somehow found this video, shut up again. Don't, whatever you're saying, you're not even talking right now, you're watching this, but shut your mouth. So I don't apologize. He's still crying. They call my parents. They send my grandma to pick me up, and they're like, well, you have to spend the next 3 days at grandma's because, you know, we have nowhere else to send you. And like after that, you can go back to the summer camp thing. So I'm like, ugh, fine. So I'm at my grandma's house for 3 days. And the entire time, I'm like plotting my revenge, bro. This kid that got me screwed. And I love my grandma. Don't get me wrong. I really do love my grandma. But when you're 11, hanging out with like a 75-year-old German woman just is not always the vibe, dog. Like, she's asking me to play gin rummy. I don't even know how to read yet. Like, it's just not a vibe. So the entire time, I'm just stewing. I'm like, stupid kid made me get in trouble. I didn't want to apologize. It's his fault. He was the one starting beef. Like, I'm annoyed this whole time. And you can't blame me. What do you want me to do? Like, obviously, I'm going to be annoyed at this guy who got me in trouble and kicked out of the place where I was having all this fun. So I talked to my grandma about it because we're eating lunch. And she asked me, she's like, what's bugging you? Because I'm picking out my sandwich. I'm all annoyed. And I basically tell her, I'm like, well, this is what happened. This kid, you know, was causing all these problems. So I told him to shut up and I got in trouble. And she basically tells me, she's like, oh, well, if he's bullying you, then the only thing you can do is like, you know, try to fight him. And I know what you're thinking. That doesn't sound like very grandma-y advice, but I call her Oma. She's from Germany. She was born in Germany in 1939. Her first 6 years were in World War II. So she's just a little tougher than most. She has a different way of viewing things. And she's like, if this kid is going to be like that and snitch and cry, then you might as well give him a reason to cry. And I'm like, okay. 11-year-old me, you know, is like, all right, look at my sage old wizard of a grandma giving me this valuable life advice, you know? And obviously, like, I don't advocate for fighting people. Don't ever do that. But if you really have a bully that won't leave you alone, sometimes the only way to take care of it is to roast them back. Like, if somebody, let's say you've got glasses and somebody's always like, oh, four eyes, oh my God, four eyes, and they're being relentless and won't leave you alone and it bugs you, the best way to get them to leave you alone is to be like, yeah, I might have four eyes, but at least I know who my dad is, Billy, okay? I guarantee you, once you do that, they're dropping it. They're not gonna make fun of you anymore. So my grandma is like, yeah, if he's got a problem, then, you know, if he's going to have a problem regardless, then you might as well give him something to have a problem about. And I'm like, yeah. So after 3 days of playing cards with my grandma, you know, I get sent back to camp and I pull up ready to go. Like, you know that Kevin Hart joke where he goes to the teacher and he walks in all hyped because he gets to swear at the teacher? That's low-key how I'm feeling. I'm not going to swear, obviously, because Susan is watching this. Please don't demonetize me. Please, please, Susan. My kids are starving. I really need this. And my grandma was also the one to drop me off. And on the way there, dude, she's like playing hype up rap music. But she tells me, don't try to start a fight with him. But like, if he's going to have a problem, then you do what you got to do. And I'll come pick you up if there's a problem. And I'm like, yeah, that's right. That's right. 11-year-old me all hyped. You know, I'm like doing push-ups on the field just to get a little pump on in case he wants to fight. And that day, like, the rec center has a pool attached, and it's a pool day, and pool days are the best, because there was a water slide, and, like, 11-year-old me, you know, is amped. It's like, oh my God, it's a pool day, I'm gonna go down the water slide, and this kid's gonna catch my hands. Like, we got a multi-step day going on. Everything is fantastic. I really don't know how the sun cannot be shining this bright every day. This is what life was made to be. So I pull up to my crew, my little crew that I was hanging out with before, and they're like, yo, Ryan, we missed you. That Reginald kid is a pain in the butt. Like, he's just been making fun of everybody, but he always cries whenever you do anything back, and, like, it's just been a pain. And I'm like, yeah, well, don't worry, bro, because if he starts anything today, papa, that's me fighting, by the way. Like, that's my fighting noises. So my friends are like, yo, that's sick. So it's pool day, like I said. So we hop in our swim trunks, we change in the bathroom. Not together, obviously, because that would be weird, but you're picking up what I'm putting down. So we change in the bathroom, and we go, and, like, we're waiting in line for the slide. And Reginald happens to be, like, two spots in front of us. And the entire time, he's, like, loudly talking to his little group of friends about how, you know, some people just shouldn't be allowed back. As if I wasn't the only person that got sent home for a couple days. Like, he's obviously saying it loud just so I can hear it. And I'm just, you know, keeping my mouth shut. I don't want to cause a problem. Obviously, I'd prefer to not get in trouble, but hey, Oma told me what Oma told me. If something goes down, I no disrespect on these streets. This is the closest thing to the streets that I have, okay? When I listen to Chief Keef, I think about 11-year-old me on a water slide. I don't think about running the streets. You gotta let me have this one. So whatever, we go down the water slide, I have my fun. And when I get to the bottom of the water slide, because I was like first in my group, before the rest of my group is there to back me up, him and his boys like start pressing me right in the pool underneath the water slide. Like, they start pushing me and being like, what? What? What you gonna do about it? And I'm like, oh, here we go. So I start pushing them back, and obviously 2 11-year-olds like just pushing each other in the water with like their heads barely sticking up out of the water just looks ridiculous. So nobody really knows that there's like a little fight going on, but we're pushing each other back and forth. And my friend comes down, and it's the kid who can burp and fart on command, by the way. That's going to be important. There's a reason I mentioned that earlier. So something you need to know about Reginald is because he's like raised by, I don't know, people that buy art or whatever. Like, he definitely has a weak stomach. He's very picky. He didn't have a very like tough childhood. His mom and dad never made him eat vegetables that were gross. He always had like, oh, my chef made creme brulee broccoli. Like, I'm sure it was great in his house. Good for him. He had good food. So we noticed that he had a weak stomach, and my friend comes down and he sees us pushing, and he comes over and he start pushing. And at this point, Reginald is like, we're taking this out of the pool. And I'm like, all right, bet. So we climb out of the pool on this ladder, and we all take turns, by the way. We don't all climb up the ladder at once. We were gentlemen about the combat that was about to go down. And now I'm up in Reginald's face again. I'm pushing him. I'm like, what? What? And he's pushing me back, but we're both afraid to throw the first punch. You know, like, neither of us wants to be the person that gets in trouble for this. And my friend who can burp and fart on command is standing there. And Reginald looks at him and is like, oh, you had to bring your trashy backup to save you. Like, I don't know where this 10-year-old had learned all these words to call people trashy and stuff, but he calls my friend that can burp and fart on command trashy. He's like, oh, you had to bring your trashy friend with you. You couldn't take me by yourself. And at that point, I think my friend had had enough, and he turns around and just pulls down his pants and bare booty farts on Reginald, bro. Like, bare booty farts on Reginald, and Reginald like almost goes cross-eyed, and the next thing out of his mouth is just and he starts gagging, and as he's gagging, he turns away from the butt that has just farted on him and vomits into the pool right at the bottom of the water slide. And to make matters worse, so it's just kind of like floating in the pool, somebody else comes down the slide like right into the vomit, straight, just the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. I didn't know that it was possible to have such a weak stomach that somebody like farting can make you throw up. But he yaks into the pool, which, you know, definitely does not pass the vibe check for most people, I'm assuming. I feel like a lot of people are not trying to swim with barf. The lifeguards blow the whistle. They have to shut down the pool. He's crying now after he's vomited. He like had to hit the double whammy, you know? Oh, I'm crying and I just vomited in the pool. And my friend is laughing hysterically on the ground because he just made this kid throw up with a fart. I'm laughing hysterically, like, on the floor because what am I supposed to do? How often am I going to see this? And his friends are even, like, trying to hold back their laughter. And he's just crying, oh, my God, that's so disgusting. Oh, my God. Ah. You know, freaking out that somebody farted on him, which, like, obviously, it's disgusting. I'm not going to lie. But considering homeboy was about to try to fight me, he really did defuse the situation in the most non-violent way possible. Like, realistically, breaking up a fight with a fart is kind of a heroic move, you know? It's pretty impressive to have bowels that stinky. And we're only there for like 30 seconds before the people running the summer camp and the lifeguards that were like sometimes the same people come over and are like, what happened, you know? And he's crying and he farted on me and I threw up. Like, you know, just the little kids sobbing when they're trying to explain what just happened. And me and my friend are laughing. They're asking us what went down. And like I said, we're just laughing. We can't help it. Like, I don't know what you want me to explain. He told you what happened. So everybody's laughing hysterically. So they separate us and put us in like these little clear rooms that were, you know, 10 feet apart, like almost like a bigger penalty box than the NHL. They had 3 of them. They were like clear conference rooms, and they put us each in one and were like, until you guys calm down and we get to the bottom of this, you guys are going to sit in here, you know, no funny business. Like, I don't want to see any goofing off or talking to each other. Do you understand? And obviously me and my friend are smiling. We're like, yeah, sure, we won't talk. And we're all sitting here in like these glass rooms, and I look over, and homeboy McDouchalot, who has just barfed in the pool, is sitting there giving me a dirty look through the glass. And listen, you can give me a dirty look, man. I'm not the one who farted on you and made you throw up. It's not like it's my bad. And about an hour later, after sitting in timeout for an hour, like the director of the program, I had been escalated. This person was maybe 20, you know, not a 16-year-old. they come and get me, and they basically ask me to explain what happened. And I don't lie. I tell them the truth from the beginning. You know, I tell them about the shoving in the pool, and they're basically like, all right, well, Reginald has gotten his deposit back. His mom and dad don't want him to come here anymore because of the little stunt that you guys pulled. So he's not going to be here anymore. You just got back from suspension. I'm not going to suspend you again, because if you get suspended twice, you can't come back. So you and your friend just have to be sure to, like, not do anything like this again. No more fighting. And I didn't have beef with anybody except for Reginald. He was, like, the only person I beefed with. And I was like, yeah, all right, deal. And the rest of the summer, I didn't have issues with anybody, because surprisingly, if you're not calling me poor and stupid and telling my friends that their dreams are dumb, I don't have a giant reason to want to push you in the pool, and my friends don't have a reason to want to fart on you. So you're pretty safe. It's not like it was something that we were really going around doing on the daily in summer camp anyways. Even though if we did, that would definitely be another story time that would end up with me in prison.
So there was this girl who I'm going to name Clarissa for the purpose of the stories, because that just sounds like a girl who's going to slap you with $100 bills while singing the national anthem. And, you know, she was a pretty unbearable spoiled kid. I don't know what her dad did, but let's just say they had stupid money, okay? They had the type of money where if you died and your brain cells had no more purpose, but you were somehow able to still eat and drink, you would still be richer than 99% of people, all right? And she knew it. And, like, you know, money's dope and all, don't get me wrong, but it's not a personality trait, okay? Like, being rich is not a personality, let's be honest here, but apparently to this girl it was, and she kind of thought that she could get away with whatever because her parents did a lot of stuff for the school, like, cool, you know, you helped out the school a lot, good for you, but that doesn't mean you get to do whatever you want. So we had a class together, and her and the teacher weren't exactly the best of friends because Clarissa had a know-it-all attitude and thought she was better than everyone, and my teacher just didn't really like to put up with that, all right? So that's a little bit of the backstory. So one day, we're sitting in class, and our teacher's like, all right, kids, so we're going to be writing paragraphs about, I don't even remember what we were reading, something about what we were reading and what the author is, like, trying to imply, you know, like, not all meanings are on the surface. Sometimes things are deeper, which, don't get me wrong, is a pretty stupid lesson. Like, sometimes the author just wanted the curtains to be blue, okay? It doesn't mean that they were signifying the depression of locking out all sunshine from their life. Like, maybe the curtains were just blue. We can just call the curtains blue, but whatever. Our English teacher wanted us to write paragraphs about some minuscule stuff in a book that nobody really cared about. And I mean, even though I didn't really care about it, the teacher told us to do the assignment. It's what they want us to do. And there's no point trying to fight with the teacher about, do I have to actually do the assignment? Like, yeah, they assigned it. Shockingly, even if you think it's stupid, the teacher is still in charge and you have to do the assignment. There's really not much you can do to get out of the situation. But Clarissa didn't take it that way. No. Clarissa decided that she was going to fight with the teacher to no tomorrow, except she didn't go about it a very clever way. Instead of being like, excuse me, teacher, can you please explain why it's significant for us to relay every single thing the author wrote into something deeper? Like, isn't it possible that the author didn't exactly have a deep intention for everything they wrote? Yeah, instead of saying it like that and having a logical argument as to why this assignment might be a little stupid, Clarissa just, like, snorted, almost like a pig, okay? Like, Miss Piggy, like, and, was like, I'm not doing this stupid assignment, which, you know, just pissed off the teacher, and I don't blame her, okay? Like, you already gotta deal with enough stuff as a teacher. The last thing you need is Clarissa up in your face like, this is stupid. Okay, Clarissa, I agree. It is very stupid, don't get me wrong. Teacher's just trying to do their job, bro. Like, they're not sitting here trying to make our lives miserable. The school district tells them what they have to teach us. They're just trying to do their job, and arguing with them and trying to, like, make them feel bad about it just makes you kind of look like a miserable person. But whatever, she's just being rude to the teacher. Except, you know, our teacher was just not in the mood to deal with it. Usually our teacher was a super chill, nice person, but I don't know what happened to her coffee this morning. I don't know if a dog happened to do the one-legged T-pose and drop a little bit of liquid in her coffee or what, but she was in a terrible mood. So here we are in the middle of class with two women, both of which are not going to back down at all, very pissed off at each other, like, on the verge of a screaming match over some stupid assignment. And basically the teacher responded to Clarissa being like, I'm not going to do the assignment as, well, then I'll fail you for the year, Clarissa. Like, fine, if you don't want to do the assignment, then I guess you don't want credit for the class, which I don't really think the teacher could do, okay? Like, don't get me wrong, I don't think the teacher really had the authority to fail a kid in the entire class because they didn't want to do an assignment. I don't think that's how it went. But Clarissa, instead of, you know, being like, oh, you can't do that, decided to say, well, it's not my fault that you're an idiot who has a terrible job and no future ahead of you. Like, sorry that your life is so miserable. Which, you know, someone has to be teachers, okay? And I think teachers do have a really, really difficult job, and I don't think they're wasting their lives and can't do anything better. Like, they're choosing to be a teacher to teach you how to exist. Like, I've had my beef with teachers, but saying that a teacher has no life and no future and sucks definitely is not a good way to get your point across, and it just makes you look like a spoiled brat, super out of touch with reality, you know? And our teacher, obviously, is defending herself, which I don't blame her for. If some preppy kid started calling me a waste of life because I wanted to be a teacher and waste my time teaching them, I would be pretty pissed too. Like, that would definitely rub me the wrong way. And she starts telling Clarissa how, you know, well, maybe if you actually had any semblance of intelligence, this wouldn't be such a hard assignment. Like, maybe if you didn't just go around flexing your dad's money all the time, there wouldn't be any issues. Which was kind of inappropriate for a teacher to say, but at the same time, sometimes the truth hurts, you know? Like, sometimes when you get a truth bomb dropped on you, it stings a little bit. So, Clarissa, you know, getting a little upset that the truth was being said, that she was being outed as a spoiled brat who does nothing but flex her dad's money, doubled down and went for the ultimate kill shot. So Clarissa says, well, haha, at least my dad loves me. And, we didn't know this at the time. I don't know if Clarissa knew this. I'm hoping she didn't, because I don't want to believe anyone is that bad of a person. But, our teacher's dad had passed away, like, 2 months before, which obviously causes the world's greatest, like, what did you just say? Like, are you kidding me? And she says, Clarissa, get out of my class. Go to the principal's office immediately. Which, to be fair, if your dad just passed away and somebody is like, at least my dad loves me, you should kind of go to the principal's office. Like, at least get a part, okay? Like, I know, I hope Clarissa didn't know that her dad had just passed away, okay? But, like, you never know. Sometimes people say really mean things when they're angry, especially women. I don't know what it is about you guys, but you guys just like to throw out like the big guns, okay? Like, I'll be arguing with a girl about like stop signs, and I'll be like, you know, I just think stop signs are important for traffic. And they're like, yeah, this is why your dad doesn't love you, Ryan. And I'm like, oh my, all right, okay. Like, I realize this has escalated past my point. Women, I don't know why you do that, but I know you guys do. So, Clarissa refuses to get out of the class and is sitting in the chair. And the teacher is getting increasingly annoyed and is like, I don't want to see you right now. Please leave the classroom before I have to call a hall monitor. And Clarissa, at this point, has decided that she's just going to send it and get in as much trouble as humanly possible. Because the next thing she does is, she was a bit of a VSCO girl and she has this iced coffee on her desk. She picks up the iced coffee and hurls it at the teacher. Like, hurls it. I'm talking MLB AAA baseball pitcher status, all right? 86 mile per hour fastball. If this was Wii Baseball, she would definitely have the sparkly bat because she was going pro. So she hucks this iced coffee at the teacher's head. And I don't know how our teacher had cat-like reflexes and dodged it. Maybe it was the heightened senses of being under attack by a spoiled rich girl. She, like, ducks it, and it smacks against the whiteboard and just pops everywhere. And up to this point, the class was being a little bit rowdy, kind of like, ooh, oh! But as soon as she threw the iced coffee at the teacher, it just goes dead silent. Like, everyone's like, oh, this is going down. Like, this is going down. This is something that we did not expect to go down on this day. Like, I'm sitting here trying to write some paragraphs, all right? I didn't expect iced coffee baseball to start breaking out in the middle of an English lesson, all right? It was not something I was ever prepared for, and I hope you guys can understand why I wasn't prepared for it. So at this point, the teacher's had enough. She goes, that's it. I'm calling security. And we had, like, this security guard that would come around. I don't really know what he was securing because he looked like the only thing he liked securing was bags of Krispy Kreme donuts into his mouth. But, like, he walks up and he tells Clarissa to, like, come with him. And she has this smirk on her face because everybody kind of knew that she wasn't going to get in any trouble. Like I said, she kind of, like, did whatever she wanted. And sure enough, she didn't really get in trouble. The school was just like, we understand that emotions get the best of people sometimes. And like I said, I don't think the teacher should have been, like, flaming the student back. But at the same time, if you dish it out, you got to be able to take it. And Clarissa was dishing it out 100%. And, you know, basically because her dad was who her dad was, she didn't really get in trouble. And, yeah. Regardless, we started knowing the incident around the school as the iced coffee incident because no one is ever prepared for iced coffee baseball that early in the morning. You know, there was still ice in the coffee. Like, this was a pretty early event in the morning, guys. And the rest of the day was full of stories about how everybody thought that the teacher was going to throw hands with Clarissa, which honestly, kudos to the teacher for not. I feel like if I was a teacher and some kid threw iced coffee at me, I would definitely be apt to throwing hands. I'd be like, you know what? I don't really care if I lose my teaching license. This is worth it. You threw coffee at me. 1v1 me, no scopes only on the playground. But yeah, Clarissa, if you're watching this, I bet you you're probably still a bad person who makes fun of people's dads dying, which is a fat yikes.
When I I was younger, for whatever reason, we would always want to hang out with girls late at night, you know, for whatever reason. I'm not going to make any explanation, but you can pretty much insinuate that when I was a young teenager, there were instances where being alone with girls without supervision was pretty fun. And when you're about 16 years old, everybody and their mom thinks driving is basically the coolest thing to exist, because not a lot of people have it. Like, when you're in that awkward stage where half the kids in your grade are 16 and can drive, and the other half have to awkwardly raise their scooter everywhere, the kids that can drive are insanely cool, and this leads to a lot of people to, you know, stretch the truth a little bit when it comes to their driving abilities or the ability to borrow a car consistently. And I mean, I get it. When you're a teenager, everything's awkward. I'm pretty sure every teenager in America is a little bit insecure at some point. That's just how being a teenager is, and it kind of sucks, but it's reality. And one night, I'm hanging out with one of my better friends at the time, who I had just kind of started to get to know. And he had this girlfriend that was hanging out with her friend, and his girlfriend was 16, and he basically says, look, they're gonna drive here. She got a car, and she has her license. They're gonna drive here, and we're gonna go to this spot on top of this mountain, and basically you're gonna make out with her friend, I'm gonna make out with her girlfriend, and we're all gonna be golden. And I mean, if that's all I have to do to make out with the girl who I thought was pretty cute, then I'm totally down, no big deal whatsoever. So whatever, the time comes, we get inside of his girlfriend's car, I meet this girl for the first time, and I had followed her on Instagram for a bit, so it wasn't that awkward, I guess. It's always a little awkward, but I don't have a ton of trouble talking, as you can tell by the fact that my job is talking to myself about stuff that I've done in my idiotic past for like 10 minutes a day. And we kind of hit it off, we start talking, everything's going pretty good. We go to Sonic, get some milkshake. Shout out to Sonic, they're not sponsoring me, but if they want to toss me the bag, I have quite a bit of stories that involve stopping at Sonic at some point in the night, because milkshakes from Sonic are just basically a good way to get to know somebody, and they're also delicious. I really don't know why I'm plugging Sonic so hard right now, but I'd appreciate them tossing the bag. Regardless, we're at Sonic, and then we go to the spot on the mountain, and obviously, we separate a little bit. I had like a picnic blanket set up a little bit higher up on the hill. They stayed in the car. And this girl and I that hit it off, you know, we got to know each other a little bit better without the talking, if you're picking up what I'm putting down. Nothing crazy, we just made out, but it was pretty fun. It was pretty enjoyable. It was really, really fun until this happened. So where we were hanging out is actually up by this water tower in my town, and there's like a service road that you can drive up to get there. And the service road has these metal dividers that are supposed to keep the road closed, and me and my friend had just jumped out and opened them because somebody had come through and cut the chain earlier. And we didn't cut the chain. Like, I swear on my channel, we did not cut the chain to open the divider thing, but we had just opened it and driven up. But someone had kept cutting this chain, and it was now starting to cost the city some money, so they were coming back and forth and checking on it. And we just so happened to be the unlucky people who had a car on top of the hill that they were looking at to find which idiot was going to the top of the hill. So as I'm making out with this girl, everything was going great. We see some bright headlights coming up, and I think it's just another group of kids coming to make out. And then the worst possible thing that can happens in the dark, you know, they turn the lights on and do one like whoop. It's not even a siren. It's just enough for us to know that that was like the warning shot, you know, that you guys just got busted. So whatever, we walk back down the hill to the car, and I'm really not worried at this point, because yeah, the cops caught us. They're probably going to yell at us for being up here, but we really didn't cut the chain, and it's not past curfew. Plus we're with a girl with a license, so there's really no problem. Or so I thought. So there's two cops in the car, and they start talking to us, and one of them takes the two girls off, and then one guy is talking to me and my friend. And I'm a pretty smooth talker, and I didn't think we had done anything wrong, so we're basically telling him, oh no, like, we're here with his girlfriend, she borrowed her dad's car, she has a license, everything's good, no big deal. And the cop is talking to us, he's like, oh, I used to bring girls up here to the water tower back in high school too, so I get it, and it won't be any problem as long as your girlfriend has her license on her and everything's good, you guys aren't doing drugs or anything. No, of course not. I'm pretty sure that we're in the clear. I'm really not stressing at this point whatsoever. I'm really like, whatever happens, I'm all right. And that's when the other cop starts walking back with the girls, and I can tell by the looks on the girls' faces and the fact that it looks like they've been crying and the officer's stern walk, that their talk did not go as good with our guys. So they get back to within earshot, and obviously the dude's partner is like all tensed up, so he says, "What's wrong?" And the other cop goes, "This girl," and points at my friend's girlfriend, "doesn't have her license." And everyone's like, "Wait, what do you mean?" And her boyfriend says, "I thought you had your license." And, you know, she looks down and is like, "No, I lied, but I took my dad's car." And the cop goes, "Without him knowing." And we're all kind of like, "Ah, crap, this is not a very good situation." And the cops are obviously annoyed because what they thought was just going to be coming up here, obviously finding some kids making out and then yelling at them, scaring them a little bit and sending them on their way, now becomes a case of four 15, 16-year-olds on top of a mountain that were just making out and are in a car that the person who owns doesn't know is missing, being driven by somebody without their license. Just a lot of paperwork. Not the night that they were low-key going for. So at this point, we kind of realize that we're going to get in trouble, and the girls are a crying mess, and they keep looking at us, and his girlfriend is like, "Do something, do something." And I'm getting annoyed with her because, great, now I'm going to have my parents come pick me up. And it is like 9 p.m. Curfew here is 11, but it's late enough where my parents are obviously going to know what I was doing with the girl at a water tower. Yeah, and I just don't want to have that interaction with my parents. That's awkward. So I'm kind of annoyed, and she keeps complaining to her boyfriend for him to do something, and he's like, "You don't have a license and your dad doesn't know we took the car. We're done. There's nothing I can do." No amount of talking is gonna let the cops let us leave. Could you imagine being able to talk your way out of that situation? At that point, you're not a person. You're like on a legendary status with Han Solo. So the cops come back after making us stand there, and they're basically like, "Look, we're gonna call all your parents. They're gonna have to come pick you up, and you, young lady, are gonna have to wait for your dad because we're gonna tell him that you stole his car." And for whatever reason, my friend's girlfriend like snaps and basically says, "You have no right to call my dad. I'm a U.S. citizen. I have every right to drive a car wherever I please," and starts like yelling at the cops. And I'm putting my head in my hands at this point and trying not to laugh or smile or do anything that makes the cops think I'm involved in this at all. If we're gonna be yelling at the cops, I'd rather my parents just come get me. Yeah, it's awkward. My mom has to know that I was making out with a girl, but it's better than this girl screaming at the cops for just doing their job. So she's yelling at the cops, and the cops are obviously annoyed, and they ask her, "Well, what would you like us to do? What would you classify taking a car without permission?" And she says, and I quote, one of the most spoiled sentences that I've ever heard, "Daddy wouldn't care that I could borrow the car," as if her dad's opinion is really what matters. The laws we have in place, the fact that you have to pass a driver's test to be able to drive a car on the road, nah, those don't matter. Throw it out just because daddy said that he wouldn't care. That's exactly what we need in America. Actually, your honor, yes, I was driving without a license because it was taken away after my 12th DUI, but need I remind you that daddy said it's perfectly okay? So she's starting to get belligerent, and the officers threaten to put her in the back of the squad car, and she looks at them defiantly and says, "You will be doing no such thing. If you lay a hand on me, I'm gonna tell daddy." Just low-key, I don't know if she had a mental snap or what, but basically became the epitome of Paris Hilton attitude. And the cops ended up putting her in the back of the car while we waited awkwardly for all of our parents. After the cops came back, they joked around though and were like, "What was her problem?" And we all uncomfortably laughed because we didn't want to say anything wrong. And thankfully, for whatever reason, my mom didn't call, and my dad was the one to pick me up, and since he's a real one, we agreed to basically never tell my mom. He wouldn't tell my mom as long as I mowed the lawns all summer, and since we live in Las Vegas, it's like 115 degrees. But I'll take mowing lawns over having to explain to my mom why my dad had to come get me with the cops calling the house at like 9 at night, because my mom goes to bed early. But real talk, it was a pretty fun night. Seeing a spoiled girl freak out on the cops definitely is not something every day, and I'm pretty sure daddy didn't end up getting her out of trouble. The good thing is her parents weren't even the type of parents to let her get away with anything, and she ended up getting grounded. So basically the end of the school year for stealing her parents' car, which is a pretty solid punishment to crime ratio. So, Dad, if you're watching this, thanks for being a real one.
Anyways, when I was about 15, I couldn't really have a job yet. In America, you have to be 16 to work, and, you know, I'm always been a hustler, okay? I like myself some gold chains and some solid ice on my wrist. And even though I was babysitting for, like, $3 an hour, I was convinced that I might actually accidentally be able to get some, you know, ice on my wrist through babysitting. So I couldn't have a job yet, and for the most part, any one of my mom's friends that needed a babysitter, my mom would be like, hey, my son will babysit your kids, and, for the most part, it was pretty easy, because I get along with kids pretty well most of the time. Today is going to be a slightly different story, so I didn't really mind it. I would just go get to hang out and goof off and get paid for it, which is an instant dub. Everybody knows that. So, whatever. One day, my mom is at this house party, and she meets this girl who she doesn't know super well, who's like, oh, I can never find a good babysitter, and my mom gives her my name. She's like, well, you know, my son is a great babysitter, he'll do it for pretty cheap, da-da-da-da-da, gives her my name, gives her my phone number, all this stuff. And, you know, I figure, since my mom met her somewhere, that this lady's probably trustworthy, and they're probably friends. Come to find out later, my mom didn't really know her at all, and had met her for the first time at the party, which is a really weird way to, you know, get your son a job, like, hey, strange lady, I don't know, can my son come over to your house and watch your children? But whatever, I guess my mom secretly had hope in the back of her heart forever that I would get kidnapped and sold to Somali pirates. I guess that's something I'm gonna have to work through with my therapist later. But regardless, I get this text and the mom's like, hey, can you come over on Friday and babysit my kids? And you know, I was like, yes, of course. As Blueface once said, get the bag, don't worry about what I'm doing, I will be there 100%. We can hang out, play some Uno, maybe me and you could play some Monopoly in front of the kids, get them an idea of what the real world's like, get them a job, all that good stuff. Now in reality, I was like, yeah, I'll be there, no problem, be there at 7. So I get the address, and you know, I was 15 at the time, so I couldn't drive, so I have to have my dad drop me off, and that's gonna be important later, because that means that I can't get home, okay? Like, unless this lady drives me home or my parents come to pick me up, I'm kinda SOL in the ride home department, okay? You know, that's kinda crappy, but that's just how it works sometimes. So I walk in, and I've babysat kids plenty of times, alright? I'm basically an expert at this point. If you gave me an army of children, I could probably coach them into getting away with the D-Day invasion. That's how good I was with kids, alright? So, I'm thinking, this is gonna be a cakewalk. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen the show Super Nanny, where the kids are actually, like, straight out of hell. But, I had never met a kid like that. I didn't think those kids really existed. I thought it was played up for TV. But as I walk in, I instantly know that this is not going to be a fun time. You see, this girl was about 9 years old, alright? And, the mom basically told me that she was just being a little unruly at the moment. And whatever, man, kids have freakouts. Hell, I was 15. I still had freakouts sometimes. Sometimes you just gotta let those emotions out. No sweat, no sweat. So she says that the 9-year-old has to clean her room before she's allowed to go outside and play, right? But she didn't want to, okay? So the mom says, I'm sorry, I wanted to get it done earlier. Is it okay if I leave? I'm a little late. And you just make sure she cleans her room before she goes outside. And I'm like, yeah, no problem. Thinking that it can't be too bad to make a kid clean their room. Like, obviously, she doesn't want to clean her room. But, you know, if the reward is you get to go outside and play with your friends, she'll probably clean the room. No big deal. So she leaves, and I start getting calls from the mom probably every 5 minutes asking if she's cleaned her room, if she's cleaned her room, if she's cleaned her room. And she had been in her room, but I hadn't gone to check because for some reason I was like, ah, she's probably just cleaning her room. Like, why would I doubt that, bro? You told me the girl was cleaning her room, and now you're calling me every 5 minutes to make sure that she's doing it. So I go to open the door and see if she's cleaning the room, and the door is locked. Right, and the door is locked, and I'm like, hey, are you cleaning your room? And she just starts screaming, I don't want to clean, I hate it, I hate it, I'm not gonna clean, I want to go outside, I want to go outside. And I'm like, okay, well, I don't know if you know this young lady, but first of all, let's use our inside voices, because we are indoors, and you're being a little inconsiderate, okay? You're in an apartment building, so there's neighbors around, and they don't want to hear you screaming, first of all. Number two, skis, I can't let you go outside until you clean your room, right? We were on the second floor of the apartment building. So she's like, okay, fine, I guess, fine, I'll clean my room. So I go sit on the couch, which is like by the front door, and a couple minutes later, I hear the door unlocked, and out, charging towards the door like a bull in a china shop. I swear she might have actually been wearing a football helmet for the sole purpose of trying to get out to the door quickly. Comes a running 9-year-old covered in marker, like she had colored all over herself. Her forehead is green, her arms have blue scribbles all over them. There is a marker covered child running for the door. So the door was locked, and thank God she was 9, so she's not smarter than a door lock. I don't know what 9-year-olds aren't, but apparently she was not smarter than a door lock. So she's yanking on the door trying to unlock it, it's not working, and she's just screaming and running around and just closing doors, slamming doors in my face, and it's like, I'm not cleaning, I'm not cleaning. You're not my mom. We're paying you. You have to listen to me. And I'm like, oh my God, what is happening? Okay. I've dealt with some weird kids, but not once have I ever dealt with a child who decides to cover their entire body with markers just to run around and scream at me that they're not going to listen to me because I'm not their mom. And during all of this, okay, the mom is still calling me. So the mom's calling me, and I'm kind of like, yeah, your daughter's going crazy. She's running around. And the mom doesn't seem fazed at all. You know, I don't know about you. If I was a parent and I was out and about and somebody was like, hey, your kid has covered themselves in marker and is running around screaming, you're not my mom. You're not my mom. Ha ha. Die, die, die. I would be a little bit concerned, but this mom just goes, ugh. She does that sometimes. And I was like, she does this sometimes. This is normal to you. No wonder you can't get a babysitter. Your kid is known in the apartment complex as a Satan child running up and down the streets going, la, 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 if I could bathe in your intestines, I would. Like, no wonder you can't get a babysitter. I wish I would have had a warning that this kid was going to be like this. I would have never accepted the job, ever, because that seems like a terrible idea. Why would I want to be here and spend my time doing this? So the mom doesn't seem fazed and is like, ugh, another freak out. Don't worry. This happens all the time. She'll calm down. And then asked me to put her on the phone. So I put the little girl on the phone, and she goes, I don't want to talk to you, and throws my phone across the room, and it hits the wall and shattered the back of it. This is when the iPhone 4 was out. Yes, I'm old, I know. I can see it in the comments. Haha, Scrubby, you're ancient. I get it, okay? I get it. I'm elderly. So whatever. My phone goes flying. It cracks the back of it. And then the mom asked me to call her three more times. So this time I have to stand in front of her to make sure she doesn't throw my phone against the wall. So I'm triggered at this point. Like, listen, little girl, you can run around, freak out, color yourself in marker, do whatever you want. To be honest with you, at the end of the day, I get to go home, and I know that my parents won't let this fly. So, you know, shattering the back of my phone is where I'm drawing the line, though. So I'm starting to get fed up, and I'm like, you're gonna clean your room. Like, I'm starting to yell at her. She's not my kid, but after you shatter my phone, I feel like I actually get to yell at you. So finally, after three phone calls, the mom finally convinces this kid to go into the room and start cleaning, right? Like, finally, she goes in there, but once again, she locks the door, and now she's not coming out. So the mom's calling me again to make sure that their room's clean, and I'm like, yeah, she's just not coming out. So I would try to get her out and, like, open the door, and I can pick locks on house doors pretty easily. It's not complicated. You just have to have something round and relatively long, and you can pop everything. That's what she said. But regardless, I get the door open, and she's like, God is speaking to me right now. God is speaking to me. And, you know, when you open the door on a child who just had a temper tantrum, threw a phone across the room, and is now saying God is speaking to her, covered in marker with weird symbols all over her, you tend to trust it. So she ignored me. She's apparently talking to God. I'm gonna let her have that conversation, you know? You guys go ahead. I'm not trying to get wrecked by a demon in the middle of an apartment building, so I'm just not gonna do this. So I leave, and I just go sit on the couch, and about 4 hours later, the kid comes out. She's cleaned her marker off. I don't know how she got all that marker off, because, I mean, she was covered in marker and says, my room's clean. So we go, and we go, and I check, and the room's clean, and I'm like, okay, I guess you can go outside. So right as I'm opening the door to, like, the house, right, as soon as I'm opening the door, her uncle pulls up. Her uncle pulls up, and he says, oh my goodness, the house is a mess. Look what you've done. Do you not know how to handle a child? How dare you? My sister isn't going to pay you for this. And I'm like, dog, listen, this girl is a stage one freak, okay? I'm sorry. You're paying me because I did not just put up with all this crap for you to not pay me. And he goes, ugh, look what you've done. We have to clean the house. You've made a giant mess. And I'm like, no, she made a giant mess. Don't blame it on me. So uncle swoops in and pretends to save the day by being that I don't know how to handle this little kid. Not that the little kid is Satan, but that I don't know how to handle her. So the mom comes home about an hour later, and the uncle stayed. And she's like, I'm not paying you because you don't know how to take care of my child. And listen, as a 15-year-old, I might seem a little bit shy, a little bit quaint on the internet, but when I was 15, I was more savage. So I basically tell her, if she doesn't pay me, then I'm gonna put on Facebook that she is a dumb whore who will never pay babysitters and she'll never get another night out again. Like, I can promise her that. And she's like, you think you're slick. Your mom said you'd be a good babysitter, but clearly you're terrible. Yes, blame me. Blame me for your terrible child. I'm sorry that I did not expect to walk into this babysitting room and have to babysit a child covered in markers, claiming that she's talking to God and saying that I'm going to die, okay? Like, I was never prepared for this. I'm 15 years old. This kid is only 6 years younger than me. I don't have double her life experience, let alone enough to know that she's not actually a religious demon who's going to eat my soul alive, all right? What do you expect me to do? If a kid's threatening you, what would you do? It's not my fault she was running around the house breaking stuff. She broke my phone. Clearly, you don't know how to control your kid. Don't say, you don't know how to control my kid, because
Your kid is out of control. It's not my responsibility. That's like putting me in a cave with a wild tiger and then getting mad when it attacks me. I don't know how to control a tiger. Am I supposed to? Is that something that they taught you in school when you were younger? Okay, I don't think so. So you're gonna pay me. So she gives me $20 for all this time and effort of having to deal with this kid, which, don't get me wrong, 20 bucks is 20 bucks. But I was there for a solid 6 hours dealing with this satanic kid who was an absolute weeaboo. And after that, I was like, okay, well, can I wait here for my dad to pick me up? And she said no. Kicked me out of her apartment, and I had to go wait in the parking lot of this apartment complex for my dad to pick me up an hour later because she came home early. So, moral of the story is, don't accept babysitting gigs from people you don't know, because there is a very strong chance that you're going to get a satanic child that will try to ruin your life and make your life miserable.